A very good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Sharon Dowie, and our first item of business is to welcome John Swinney to his first formal meeting of the committee. Sharon Dowie will attend next week as she has a prior commitment in London with the Public Audit Committee. And I look forward to working with both of them, and I repeat our thanks to Jamie Green and Colette Stevenson, whom they replaced. So let me now invite John to declare any interests that are relevant to the remit of the Criminal Justice Committee.
Thank you, Convener. There's nothing from my register of interest that I believe I require to declare of relevance to the work of the committee. However, I need to state that I served, as colleagues will know, in the Scottish Government until March 2023 and participated in collective decision-making on issues that will come before the committee during this term. In addition, for the period July 2022 to March 2023, I took direct personal decisions in relation to the Scottish Budget, which is relevant to material before the committee today and likely to be on other occasions.
Thank you very much indeed. And I'd also like to welcome Donald Cameron, who is attending today as Sharon's substitute, as this is his first time with us. I'd also like him to declare any interests that are relevant to the remit of the Criminal Justice Committee.
Thank you, Convener. Just one interest to declare, and namely that I am a member of the Faculty of Advocates.
Thank you very much indeed. So our next item of business is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. So our next item of business is to begin our pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's 2024-25 budget. So we have two evidence panels today, and I intend to run each of them for up to around 90 minutes. And I'm pleased to welcome our first panel of witnesses today. They are Jane Connors, DCC, Crime and Operational Support, David Page, Deputy Chief Officer, and James Gray, Chief Financial Officer with Police Scotland, Ms Lynn Brown, Chief Executive with the Scottish Police Authority, and Mr Ross Haggart, Chief Officer, Stuart Stevens, Deputy Chief Officer, and John Thompson, Acting Director of Finance and Procurement with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I thank the witnesses who provided written submissions. I'd also like to thank the Scottish Police Federation and the Association of Scottish Police Superintendents for their written submissions that were received after we put out the papers. And I'd also like to thank the Fire Brigades Union similarly for their submission, which was likewise received after the papers were published. And these have all been sent separately to members and published online. So given the size of the panel, I'm going to ask everyone to be as succinct as possible in their questions and answers, and if members can, to direct their questions to one or more of the witnesses, at least initially. I'd also invite each organisation present to try and field just one person initially to respond. So, having said that, I'd like to begin with a very open question for us all just to get the session underway. So, during scrutiny last year, all three organisations here today painted a challenging picture on the state of their budget, although this was relieved in some part by extra funding allocated by the Scottish Government. So, can I invite Police Scotland, the SPA, and then Scottish Fire and Rescue, to tell us briefly, if you can, how have the finances for 2023-24 worked? What is the financial situation that you've been working in? And what concerns you have and commentary that you have as we approach the 2024-25 settlement? So if I can maybe come, first of all, to Mr Gray.
Thank you, Convener. So the settlement that we received for the current financial year was a total increase in resource funding of £80 million. But of that amount, almost half of it related to squaring the pay settlement that had been agreed last year. So with regards to new money, it meant just over £40 million. When we were trying to set our budget during the course of the year, what that meant was that there was a requirement for us to reduce police officer numbers and to reduce the level of overtime that had been seen in the previous financial year, and also to look to reduce police staff numbers by a commensurate amount to the 600 police officer reduction, as well as non-pay savings in order to set a balanced budget. So DCC Connors would be a better place to talk about the operational implications, but from a financial perspective, what that has meant in the current year is that our budget has been under considerable stress, and we have been reporting that through Police Scotland and into the Scottish Police Authority, that we have seen month-on-month overspends, which has resulted in us having to put together a plan in August that was approved within Police Scotland on the 8th of August of £18.9 million of additional measures that we would need to take in year in order to bring the budget position back into line. That's primarily as a result of overtime being above what was in the budget, which I think is a consequence of the officer reductions and the additional pressure that puts on the service that has seen us overspend on overtime, albeit we are managing that very carefully on a fortnightly basis. Senior officers from across the service are coming together to scrutinise overtime from right across the service to see if there's areas where we could look to reduce that, but we are still seeing overspends there. We're still seeing overspends on police staff numbers. We have a recruitment pause in place, which is causing organisational pain. That said, the usual turnover of staff has reduced considerably, so we're not seeing the level of savings that we would expect from that. So we are looking at other places now, such as the budget that we set aside for investment for the purposes of transformation, to repurpose some of that money in order to plug the gap that we currently have in this financial year. And I suppose with regards to next year, what that means for me, I suppose, is an element of trepidation, that if we're to continue to see a similar settlement which is below what's required to stand still and therefore requires reductions in the overall service, that the compounding effect of that would be that, you know, it becomes progressively harder. And given that the service has taken out £200 million through police reform in the early years, where there's been big efficiencies through economies of scale and procurement, there's been significant reductions in the estate, albeit that is a place that we absolutely recognise that there's further opportunity, and we are about to go to the police authority to seek permission to start the consultation on the closure of 30 police stations. There's more that can be done in that space, but the workforce reductions, I think, are the most challenging area. And if we continue on a track where the settlement doesn't meet our requirements to stand still, as it were, to, you know, that kind of real terms protection that we had seen in some of the years gone past, then it's just my concern is around that compounding effect and the challenges that will present on the service, which are already significant, as I say, with the overspend that we have. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. I'll maybe bring in DCC Connors in a second, but if I can maybe just come back to David Page and just ask if there's anything that you maybe want to add to Mr Gray's.
Thanks, Convener. As James has said, and we took on a £54 million budget challenge this year alongside the officer reduction, and we're up against a £19 million mitigation plan at the moment, which we're struggling to meet. Where we're going to go with that this year is probably, as James has touched on, is into the reform budget, which is has £20 million of the reform had been baselined into our budget for this year. But what we're looking at the moment is reviewing all of our projects and programmes to see which ones we can either pause or stop to reallocate the monies effectively to fund the budget gap. We're trying to protect the rollout of national body-worn video and the associated projects, because obviously we've been looking for that for a very long time. However, the priority is to kind of balance the books, and I think we're going to have to take a lot of pain in our transformation budget this year just to balance the books. The problem with that then is it delays the multi-year programmes into next year, And if we have to reduce the headcount by another 800 as we go into the following year, I'll be using the reform budget to prop up the budget at that point. So that really slows down our capability. And one of the things that we had been hoping for is as the workforce reduces, you use capability enhancement to offset it. But if we're having to redirect our transformation budget into meeting budget pressures, then we've got workforce going down and we've got capability standing still, which effectively means we backslide on that, which has a clear operational impact on our operational colleagues. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much. DCC Connors, I'll come to you now.
Thank you. So just to highlight some of the operational impacts, as I say, with limited resources and limited capability, that is going to impact on our ability to respond to different areas. So we are looking at how we shape our service to make sure that we define our core policing to reduce demand and increase capacity. We've already seen in some of our quarter one figures our changes in service levels and our ability to deliver to the public on our outcomes that we're seeing a reduction in quarter one. We've already seen, and it's out in the public domain, some of the roads policing difficult and hard choices that are having to be made, prioritising things like 999 over 101 so that we can make sure that we manage the threat, harm and risk and vulnerability and protect the most vulnerable in the communities of Scotland. So that's just an overview of the impact that it's starting to have, the hard choices and decisions that we're having to make around how we deliver our service going forward as a result of the limited budgets that we have.
Thanks very much. Lynn Brown, I'll come to you next if you'd like to add anything to what we've heard already.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, what you've heard from Police Scotland is consistent with the authority's consideration when the budget was set. The budget allocation, as you said, in 2023-24 was better than anticipated, and we recognise and appreciate that given the challenging fiscal environment being felt across the public sector. And when the budget was set in March 2023, the authority were quite clear on their priorities. They wanted a balanced budget. They wanted prioritisation around areas of harm and the vulnerable. And they wanted the maintenance of 999. At that time, when they considered the budget, in the papers it did say that the financial year would see reduced levels of service in terms of delivery and capacity as it adjusted to the new funding model. What we've heard today is areas that the authority are expecting to be prioritised as they expected back in March 23.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'll come to you now, Mr Haggart.
Good morning, Convener, and morning, Committee, and thanks very much. As we've outlined in our submission before you today, we received an additional £14.4 million from Scottish Government in our resource budget for 2023-24, and that took our resource budget up to just over £308 million for the year. And while we were very grateful for that additional funding and its assisting with pay awards for staff, we have still had to achieve savings of £11 million this financial year. As we've outlined our savings plan within our submission, it details areas of our budget that were approved by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service Board for our budget for this year. And these savings that we've identified for this year have come across the whole organisation. Some savings have come from our service delivery arrangements and some from our support functions as well, as we've sought to make those savings. And similarly to Police Scotland, it's led to us having to make some very difficult decisions this year. In respect of service delivery, and based on our evidence-led modelling, we've temporarily removed 10 second or third appliances from multi-pump stations, and those were selected that would have the least impact upon community safety across Scotland. Aligned to this, we have also implemented changes that we identified within our operational strategy to our high-reach appliances, placing them in the most strategic locations where they can provide the most optimised and effective community safety response on a pan-Scotland national basis. And we've also amended the crewing arrangements for water rescue at Polmadee Community Fire Station so that's more in line with other water rescue stations throughout Scotland. In addition to those service delivery savings. We've also identified savings from some of our support functions. An example of the types of savings that we have identified as a recent decision to declare our office premises in Hamilton as surplus to requirements, and that will yield annual recurring savings for us and also a potential capital receipt for reinvestment. In terms of our financial position from 2024 onwards, we've modelled a number of scenarios, largely dependent upon what future pay awards and inflation might look like for the organisation up until 26-27. And those correspond with the timescales set out within the resource spending review. These illustrate that based on the flat cash assumption within the resource spending review, we may need to make additional savings of between £14 million and £26 million next year alone. And by 26-27, our modelling indicates that that may rise to between £37 million and £48 million. And as I say, that's against a resource budget of just over £308 million. We've also outlined in our submission savings that have been achieved to date through the reform of the Fire and Rescue Service in Scotland since 2013. And our submission highlights how those savings have been realised, which have resulted in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service now being very lean in terms of the structures that we've got within the organisation and also our expenditure. We also highlight within our submission that around 80% of the costs of the service cover staff costs, and of that, 80% relate to operational staff. The combination of these factors means there's very little scope for us to make significant savings within the service without reducing firefighter and specifically whole-time firefighter numbers, and again, we've illustrated that within the submission. And if we were have to reduce our firefighter numbers to the extent that our modelling suggests, then we do not believe that this could be achieved without impacting upon the safety of the communities that we are here to serve within Scotland. We've also provided information in our submission in respect of our capital budget. And as outlined, this has remained at the current level of £32.5 million per annum for the last 7 years. And clearly over this time, the spending power of that money has diminished as a result of inflation and other factors. We now adopt a risk-based approach to our capital budgeting. And we believe through this that we require a sustained investment of around £60 million per annum in our capital to address the significant backlogs that we have got. In particular, within our submission, we've highlighted issues we have with 14 of our stations that have reinforced autoclave aerated concrete, which is getting a lot of media attention, I know, at the moment across the public sector, and that's been used in 14 of our stations within the construction of their roofs. This is a problem that we've been aware of since 2019, and while we've got mitigation measures in place, permanent solutions are required because they're key locations for us to operate from across Scotland. We've also highlighted the overall condition and suitability of our property portfolio. Particularly, we recognise the need for us to prioritise firefighter safety in respect of contaminants, and we seek to provide dignified facilities across our estate for all staff and visitors to our premises. Moving on to the environment, we're committed to mitigating the impact of our activities on the environment. We have, however, not been able to invest as much as we would like to in recent years in technological solutions to assist with this due to other risk-based priorities in our capital budget. We have been able to secure additional ring-fenced money from Scottish Government for energy efficiency and carbon reduction initiatives, but not to the scale to meet our ambitions in this regard. We are committed to safeguarding our communities from the effects of climate change and have invested recently in increasing equipment and training for our firefighters to deal with increased risks associated with wildfire and flooding. And these are areas we would like to prioritise in the future. And finally, convener, we do recognise the need for us to modernise as an organisation. We believe through this modernisation, supported by an ability to reinvest internally generated savings, and with modest additional investment, we can do so much more to protect and enhance community safety and wellbeing across Scotland. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Mr Haggar. I'm quite keen to open up questions to members, so unless Mr Thompson or Mr Stevens have anything further to add, if I can ask you to make it fairly brief.
Very brief, Convener. Thank you. Basically, just to add to this year, our forecast position is just over £1 million of an overspend, is what our forecast is. And that is really around to pressure on the £11 million worth of savings. It comes through in terms of our overtime position as well, similar to what Police Scotland have mentioned. But we've also got pressure on our property maintenance, our service contracts, etc., as inflation has been added through into those contracts. So just wanted to add a little bit of context around this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, so now I'm going to move on and just invite members to come in. What I'd like to do is just invite members one at a time and give them around 10 minutes to ask their questions. So I'm just going to hand straight over to Mr. Russell Finlay.
Thank you very much. Good morning, panel. A pilot project, this is a question for DCC Connors. A pilot project in North East Scotland will see certain crimes not being investigated. Do you envisage this pilot to be extended elsewhere in Scotland?
So I think with the changes that we're facing in the budget, the limited resources and the need to reduce demand and increase our capability, the pilot's being introduced, but actually what it is, the first thing I would say is we want to make sure that the public do phone us, they do report their crime. We do not in any way want people to get the perception that we're not going to record their crime and not going to investigate it. So when somebody calls us, we'll go into the call centre and it will be looked at in terms of having a discussion with the caller. Is it something, I don't like using the word minor offences because minor is very subjective to the person who's actually the victim of that crime, so I'm not going to use that term. But is that particular crime suitable to be able to go through the process where our resolution teams will speak to the caller and find out whether or not there are any proportionate investigation leads in relation to that? If there doesn't feel that there are any proportionate leads in relation to that, it's also QA'd by a police officer to bring a police lens to it. It can then be closed and the caller will be told at that time that there's not going to be an investigation. The key part to this is that the callers will make sure that there is what's called a thrive assessment, which is all about identifying, is there any threat, is there any harm, is there any risk, or is there any vulnerability? And each individual person's assessment across all of those is very, very different. So that means that every single individual call will be assessed against those, and they will be key factors as to whether or not that crime is suitable for this process. We need to see the results of the evaluation. We need to see the results on demand, but we also need to see what the communities and our scrutiny panels within those areas feel about the actual pilot itself.
So it's safe to say there's no plans to roll it out further at this stage?
We need to see what the evaluation is, but as we've already said, the hard choices that we're facing, the lack of resources, we need to be able to reduce demand in a proportionate way, make sure that we still manage any risk to the communities of Scotland, but provide a service as well.
Thank you. It has been reported, and this I think is also for DCC Connors, that the cost to Police Scotland of Operation Branch Form has now exceeded £800,000. And I know we cannot and should not talk about the investigation, but can you provide us with an update on the cost and indicate whether it's expected to rise further?
I'm not going to comment on anything to do with Branch Form. It's an ongoing investigation. It would be completely inappropriate for me to comment.
But even in terms of cost?
It's an ongoing investigation and I really would not comment on it at all.
Okay, thank you. This is probably a question for Mr. Page or Mr. Gray. The Association of Scottish Police Superintendents, in their submission, make reference to Police Scotland having a problem with the reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete. We've already heard from Mr. Haggart that SFRS have similar problems with 14 stations being identified at a cost of fixing it about £70 million. I don't see any reference in the Police Scotland submission about this issue. I just wondered if it has been identified as a problem, what the extent of that is in terms of numbers of premises and perhaps even some kind of idea of cost.
Okay, thank you for your question, Mr. Findlay. So we have assessed RAC across our entire estate. We did so through the month of April this year when we identified some crumbling rack in the Fettes workshop as part of a routine repair. And as a consequence of that work, we've identified three locations across our estate where rack has been identified. Fettes is the most significant site, where there are 10 areas covering over 4,000 square metres where there is rack in the roofing. The estimated cost of repair there is just over £4 million. Given the age and the condition of Fettes, which has been underinvested in for many decades, it's not economically viable to make those repairs, and we are looking to go to the police authority next week to get permission to start a consultation on exiting Fettes and relocating elsewhere within Edinburgh. The other two locations, not quite as significant. One is Ballooneyfield in Dundee, and the estimated cost of repair there is £1.25 million. And what I should say is there is no risk to anybody working in these sites. We have removed people from the affected locations, and we've put emergency pillars in place to ensure, and safety nets to ensure, that there is no debris falling from these roofs. The last one is in Perth, and this is very, very, very small. It's in a boiler room. It's only the estates team that have access to it. We've put those kind of security, the safety measures in place, so we're not preparing or not proposing to do any work on that site at present, and we will just continue to monitor the condition of it, because it doesn't pose any significant risk to anybody at this point in time. So, in summary, three locations, one of which is significant, and the other two are quite manageable. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much. Okay. In terms of policing costs more generally, the submission from Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority talks about hard choices needing to be made, and that this does not allow the organisation to maintain the workforce at the levels of previous years. Now, in your opening statement, I think the last identified number of police officers was around 16,600. Can you tell us, first of all, what that number is just now, and also what's the best projection in terms of where we might end up based on the proposed budget?
As of last week, it was about 16,600, so we are at that number, give or take. Obviously, it ebbs and flows as people resign and whatever. In terms of projections, as we've said, one of the things about workforce reduction for Police Scotland is we have 16,600 officers and we've got 5,500 civilian staff. We've talked about proportionate reduction in the workforce to try and maintain the balance. One of the things about police officer numbers in Police Scotland is because the numbers are so large relative to the civilian staff, and because of the turnover, the attrition rate, on average we would bring in about 200 probationers per quarter. So there's quite a high numbers of volumes constantly coming in. If we need to reduce the workforce, the easiest lever to use, if you like, is to reduce probation numbers. But the problem with that, of course, is then every time you're looking at a workforce reduction, the first place to go is to reduce the workforce in terms of the police officers. What we don't want to do, though, is to make the overall workforce unbalanced between the mix of police officers and staff. We are looking to reduce our staff numbers, but obviously the regulations and rules in relation to staff are very different. So we are investigating how we would rebalance the workforce better by pulling down the numbers of staff. Our attrition rates are very low in staff, so we can't. The natural attrition of staff doesn't allow us to just have a natural rebalancing, unfortunately. We have said if the budget comes flat, as we have to plan for, we are expecting that we would need to lose, on the face of it, another 600 police officers and another 200 staff going into next year. But that number would need to be reduced by the 1st of April 24 in order to have the cost played through the entire year. We've taken the decision not to take the action now to reduce the workforce further to allow us to cope with a flat budget settlement for next year, because we would need to do that in terms of the timeline that runs up, because we're already struggling to reduce the workforce on the staff side without actually turning off probation recruitment for the balance of the year. So we're wrestling with that problem at the moment, but with a flat budget, we would need to reduce the overall workforce as we go into next year.
Thank you. A very, very quick question. It's really quick, and it's for Mr. Haggart. I'd asked you previously about this electric fire engine that had been bought and deployed to Cambus Lang. The last position from Scottish ministers was that it was due to enter service this summer. I'd just like to ask, first of all, whether it has done so and whether this has incurred additional cost and whether you plan to purchase more of these.
Yeah, so the appliance at the moment is undergoing training with the personnel. We needed to do some work at Cambus Lang as well in terms of the electrical charging infrastructure. So there's training ongoing at the moment for that appliance. It's very much a pilot, working with a local Scottish coach builder, very much a pilot that we are undertaking for this appliance. So there's only one that we are purchasing at the moment. There are no additional costs associated with any timescales, and it's very much an emerging technology in terms of electrical appliances for heavy appliances. So we are very much working with the contractor, undertaking a pilot, and we will evaluate it before making any decisions.
What's your most likely anticipated use for it to go into service?
Timescales. Training's ongoing just now. We would hope to get it into service this calendar year.
Right, OK. Thank you. Brilliant. Thank you very much.
OK, thanks very much. I'll bring in Rona Mackay for the smallest supplementary.
On Russell's line of questioning, which is probably for Mr. Page. Can you tell us what the current recruitment, you talk about probationary recruitment numbers, what's the current recruitment numbers in the police, and how is that balanced against the police that you're,
So we've got about, I think it's about 192 that I think are starting next week, which is the kind of September intake. There's another intake planned for December and another one planned for the new year. Mm-hmm. So at the current times, we're having to look. Obviously, the September intake will go ahead because we're expecting them in the college next week. The intakes for December and the intake into the new year would both be around about the 190 number, given the attrition rate we've got at the moment. We are actively looking at the overall size of the workforce, the budget pressures we've got at the moment, and whether we need to dial down the probationary intakes pre-Christmas and into the new year. The effect on this year's budget would be relatively marginal, but what it would do is help us as we go into the next financial year. Again, that would put more pressure on the operational side because of it's the probationers that go into the front line effectively. They go out into local policing divisions, so we would be reducing the numbers that would go through there.
Okay. Thanks very much. Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in Pauline McNeill, followed by John Swinney. So, Pauline.
Thank you. Good morning. So my first set of questions is a follow-on from Ron Mackay also. I think we need to understand in some detail what I think, David, you said about that reduction in headcount of 800. So, I mean, that's a significant number. So could you just be clear, is that police officers and staff?
Yeah, so the planning we're doing for 24-25, because obviously we get our budget settlement around about the December time, so we need to be putting in our submissions before then. Working on a flat capital and a flat revenue assumption, which is the planning assumptions we've been given, as of the rest of the public mm-hmm. sector, we've built into our planning assumptions an assumption of a 2% pay rise. We're not saying that's what would be given or we wouldn't be giving, but we need to build something in. A 2% pay rise on our current budget would need £50 million of additional savings. £50 million.
So why a 2%?
It's a working assumption. We have to build. So the guidance in
but inflation's considerably higher than that. Is that what your projection is, that it will come down to 2%?
No, it's not our. The guidance that we're working with at the moment is that it's a
government guidance.
Factor.
Do you mean?
Sorry.
The government guidance is 2%.
Public sector strategy in terms of the policy document. It's not a policy document. It's a strategy document. Right. Okay. So we need to put a number into the budget that we allocate some money for the pay settlement. We did the same for this year. It's the most reasonable number we can afford within the budget. Our biggest issue is 85% of our entire headcount is staff. The non-pay budget is £200 million, and the pressure from inflation on the non-pay budget means that we're struggling to meet that number. For next year, we've assumed a very modest 2% on the assumption that inflation does come down. If we have to save £50 million to pay that 2%, we can only make that saving through people. And effectively, look at the right, 1% is 11.5 million. 11.5 million is 225 staff, roughly, and that's split between officers and staff. So that's how we get to the 800. It's a proportionate reduction on both officers and staff.
So
600 officers, 200 staff.
Right. And over what period?
If the budget comes as predicted as flat cash, we would need to take the workforce down by that number by the 1st of April 24. We actually can't do that because we don't have enough levers to pull. Even if we stopped all the probationer intake in December and the probationer intake in March, it would not get us down to the number we need to do. So we would be looking to other mechanisms like voluntary redundancy, potentially coming to the government and seeking compulsory redundancy.
That's pretty stark, isn't it? I mean, so the committee has heard the projections on retirement numbers given sort of pension changes. I take it that's still ongoing as well. So
it is, but not as bad as it was. We had a surge in April last year where pension rules changed effectively, and we had a peak of effectively officers that had served 50 years, were 50 years old with 25 years service who could leave. And that did lead to a number of retirals. That has evened off now. So we've got a kind of normal run rate of that. So that's built into our attrition figures at the moment.
Thank you very much. That's helpful. Could I ask DCC Jane Connors, you must be concerned about the reputation of the Scottish Police Force, given what we've heard this morning about, I mean, it's fair to say, and I have said it in my 19-year career, that Scotland has had an exemplary force. We do things differently here. The 101 service and many other examples. Have you got concerns as the leadership, if you like, of police organisation about this?
We obviously have concerns. You know, it's one thing about Police Scotland, its staff, its officers, they want to absolutely deliver the best service to the public that they possibly can. You know, and we are asking at the moment officers and staff to do everything that they've been asked to do with less staff, and that can't continue. So I say the difficult choices are going to have to be made about where resources are put, what the service looks like, whether it takes us longer to get to some places and deal with different things. So absolutely, Police Scotland, the executive and every officer and staff in it is finding that really difficult. But that's the situation that we're in. Those are the difficult choices and the processes that we need to go to make sure that we do keep the public safe. We prioritise, we look at threat, harm and risk. Where do we need to put our energy? Mm-hmm. There's been some fantastic results this week in the media.
Concerned. Thank you. What we've just heard from David then, I'm just making an assumption here, but my concern would be about the cadet programme then as well. If you have to reach out and reduce the recruitment, is that likely to happen, of new cadets, of new police officers?
You mean probationers?
Probationers, sorry.
Yeah.
So that programme could be compromised?
So it's absolutely one of the levers that can be looked at, depending on what the future looks like. What do we need to do around probationer recruitment, and how does that stack up with the numbers? And it's again, and as DCO Page has said, it's about the profile of Police Scotland, experience, new officers coming in, and how we maintain that balance, because you always have to have a pipeline because of the attrition rate as well. So that's something that needs to be looked at. But it absolutely is a lever that is on our consideration.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Amazing how quickly time goes. 10 minutes is a long time. Can I now ask the Fire and Rescue Service to address one or two questions I have? Ross, you know that I've raised, as other members, the issue about decontamination facilities. Now, do understand at least the basics of the difference between the revenue and capital budget. What progress do you think we're going to be able to make about getting shower facilities and the required facilities to keep fire and rescue officers safe? Or do you have concerns about your ability to do that?
Yeah, thanks, Ms McNeill. So, Firefighter safety and community safety are our number one priority within the service, and it's absolutely incumbent upon us to protect our firefighters as they in turn protect communities. And we're really committed to working with the Fire Brigade Union on the contaminants issue. We've got a dedicated contaminants working group within the organisation that is led by one of our assistant mm-hmm. chief officers and has Fire Brigade Union representation on it as well. And in essence, in terms of protecting firefighters, there are some procedural, practical things that we can put in place, and we're putting in place at the moment. But there is also a need to have an infrastructure within the organisation to make sure that our firefighters are able to properly decontaminate when they come back to station. And we've got some figures within our submission that shows, you know, the kind yeah. of the suitability of our estate, and our estate not being suitable at all in terms of contaminant control within fire stations, in terms of people being able to decontaminate and clean yeah. back in fire stations. And that's a real concern for the organisation. As I mentioned earlier, we've received £32.5 million of a capital allocation for the past 7 years, and it looks like that will be the case going forwards, and there's simply not enough capital money for all of the capital priorities yes. that we've got. But we are trying to work through that as best as we can. We have a programme in place at the moment whereby we are looking to rebuild and refurbish 3 fire stations, each refurbished or rebuilt on an ongoing basis, but with an estate of 357 fire stations, that will take a considerable period of time to work through with our current budgetary constraints. We are also looking at alternative construction methods for fire stations, and we're doing some work at the moment to develop a business case round about modular type premises that can be constructed off-site and then built to replace fire stations. A business case has been developed at the moment with partners and with the support of the Scottish Futures Trust. We believe that would be a particular solution within more remote rural areas of Scotland. They're carbon neutral buildings, and we also believe that, as well as having a fire station, additional modules could be added on to that model for other partners to use, so we would truly create community resilience hubs within more remote rural parts of Scotland. So we are looking at innovative solutions to the problem yeah. at the moment.
Is it possible that the committee could get any sort of concrete examples of where that was going to happen? I realise I've used my time up, but it would be helpful just to mm-hmm. see how the delivery is going to be rolled out.
More than happy to provide any further information off table to the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay, so I'm now going to bring in John Swinney, and then I'll bring in Donald Cameron.
Thank you very much, Convener. My first question, I think, is probably directed towards Lynn Brown and to the Deputy Chief Constable. And I'm interested in the interaction between the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland about the design of the policing model and its sustainability, given the extraordinary pressures of inflation that have been wrestled with within the public finances. So I'm interested to understand what role the Scottish Police Authority takes in essentially scrutinising and challenging the plans and propositions of Police Scotland, and the degree to which the authority is satisfied that Police Scotland is properly and fully considering, and the authority is doing this, what are the appropriate approaches to policing given the fiscal context in which we are all having to operate at the present moment. And flowing from that, and this is where the question is perhaps relevant to the Deputy Chief Constable, is the process that is undertaken by Police Scotland to assess the role and the capacity of Police Scotland, given the fact that although we are wrestling with extraordinary high inflation at the present moment, we are also experiencing some of the lowest crime levels that we've experienced in over 40 years. So perhaps Lynn Brown would Yeah. Talk about that.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Mr. Swinney. Yes, in terms of the role of the SPA, in statute we have sort of four roles, which is to support the police, to advocate on their behalf, to maintain policing, and to hold the Chief Constable to account. And against all of that, we are very clear at the authority that operational autonomy sits with the Chief Constable. Our role is to give a public window to the Chief Constable and the operational decisions that are taken, and to hold them to account in a public space to explain. And that's when I went back, if I go back to my opening statement around the budget. So I said quite clearly the authority had key expectations on that budget that were discussed in detail in public with the Chief. Going forward in the current year, the authority are focusing on capacity, which is the issue of demand, capability, which is technology and transformation, and culture, which is on the back of the statement by the previous Chief Constable in institutional discrimination. In terms of how we manage our, how we deliver on our oversight, we have got a system of committees, and you've heard some being referenced today, the Resources Committee. Those meetings are held in public. Though the papers are in public, the discussions are in public. Again, that public window for the public interest to see how Police Scotland are delivering on their obligations. We have a range of other committees. A very important one is the Policing Performance Committee, which was held yesterday, and they focus very much on the some of the things we've touched on today around the North East pilot, the downturn in performance, particularly around 999. And the view of the committee very much is they understand there are priorities, they want to understand them better, they want to understand how Police Scotland have come to those priorities, and more importantly, they want the decision around the priorities very much communicated to the public so there's understanding. So we're very clear we have a role as that public window to hold the Chief Constable to account, but they have got operational autonomy.
But that does involve the providing the necessary challenge,
yes,
to ensure that from the public interest point of view, policing approaches are commensurate with exhausting every avenue for efficiency and effectiveness.
If I may, Mr. Swinney, absolutely. And the authority are very much focused on that. So, for example, the authority meeting in August heard from Police Scotland on the challenges that they were facing now in terms of delivering against the demands that they have within the financial envelope they have. And it was decided then there will be a focus at the Resources Committee on exactly what Police Scotland are doing to make changes or to take decisions to come back within budget. So very much they want to understand it, they want to understand it and how it will impact against the priorities that we set and against the community interests. So we are very much holding the police to account for those decisions in public.
Thank you.
So in answer to your question, I think Lynn Varon has covered most of it. In terms of holding us to account, the committees in particular that sit under the main SPA board, there's a number of subcommittees where challenging and scrutiny come into play, constructive discussions as well, but absolutely where Police Scotland bring forward their operational discussions and things that are going forward. So I do think that there is a constructive yet challenging oversight from the SPA into Police Scotland, which is as it should be.
And I'm interested in the part of my question which relates to the experience that we have now in society, whereby crime is at a comparatively speaking much lower level, and I'm interested in what the implications of that are and what the consideration of those issues are in influencing the size of the police estate. And we've heard points been raised this morning about police numbers. But I'm interested in how that flows into your assessment of the degree of risk that exists within society that has to be handled.
Absolutely. And I think, we have got low levels of crime. There are certain crimes that are increasing. We're also seeing complexity levels in crime and investigation of crime. So large online elements in different areas of crime. Sextortion, we've got threatened extortion where many of the perpetrators are actually not in Scotland at all, they're abroad. you've got fraud. So there's a lot of complexity in crime at the moment. I think that's one of the big changes. While volume might be down in some areas, we are seeing significant complexity. What that then requires is our ability to have the capability, the capacity to be able to train staff, to be able to manage the different crime types that are coming along, as well as being in the communities and dealing with the traditional levels of crime. People want to see us and be visible. So being able to do all of those different things with the limited resources, that's part of the work that we're doing in terms of the service model and trying to project forward the different crime types that are going to be coming towards us. If you look at vulnerability, which is also increasing, and that's not just mental health, but actually the different levels of vulnerability, COVID has had an impact on society, as you will know. And we see that demand coming into policing as well, which is why working with partners and being really clear about how we can collectively look at the systems, which I think is something that the HMICS has said around working more collectively together and looking at systems. But coming back to your question, that ability to look at the complexity of crime, not just the volume, and be able to deal with all of those different elements is something that features in how we need to move forwards. That capability, our mobile ability, command and control, how we get contact with different people, and how we manage cases, evidence, all of that is part of our capability and requirements going forwards.
Thank you. Just to follow up that point, I was interested, and I assume that you've seen the submission that the committee's had from the Superintendents Association, but one paragraph there in page 3, it says the Scottish Government do have clear strategic objectives, but the public services are not sufficiently linked in at the tactical and operational levels. And I'm interested in that because I think it throws up the... I appreciate some of the challenge, having spent time with some of your own officers in my own constituency. I see it firsthand, some of the challenges that are experienced because of kind of wider social questions that police officers are faced with. But that point from the Superintendents Association rather struck me as being an area that is in need of further development. And I suppose I'm interested in what Police Scotland is doing to drive that degree of connection that is essential to make sure that members of the public with vulnerability are able to be supported by integrated services that stretch beyond just what Police Scotland can do and how Police Scotland is enabling that to be the case.
So I think working at a divisional level and a very local level is really important. And that's one of the things that Police Scotland, we have the central units, we have specialists, but they all link back in locally, because that's really important, because certainly in terms of confidence, we see local confidence higher perhaps than we do as some of the overarching. So it is really important that we do that. Being able to link in with the divisional commanders, being linking in through questionnaires and having different mechanisms to be able to get feedback from the public, and being able to do that in a way that is inclusive, so we are able to get different voices and different people to be able to feed back into us. I think that's absolutely essential, because what that will enable us to do is form and devise our services as we go forward. It's very important, and one of the things that we are doing in Police Scotland, this is not a top-down approach. We need to listen to the officers on the ground, we need to listen to their links with the community and understand how we then build our services, particularly with partners, to have a much better approach.
I may add, in terms of from the perspective of the SPA, in terms of how it impacts on local areas, there is a strategic partnership was signed this year between COSLA, Police Scotland and the SPA to make that understanding of what's happening in communities and to derive solutions much easier. And Councillor Maureen Chalmers, who is one of the COSLA leadership, sits on the Police and Performance Committee to bring that focus to the authority and to be aware of what is required in communities. So there is a strategic intent there with local government.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Donald Cameron now, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay. And if I can remind members and our witnesses just to be as succinct as possible so we can get as many questions in. Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. Can I start with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service? And the phrase that was used about community safety and an impact on community safety, can I just get some sort of concrete examples of what that means? What exactly do you fear might happen in terms of safety to the public?
Yeah, thanks very much, Mr. Cameron. So, from a Scottish Fire and Rescue perspective, in terms of delivering services to communities, similarly to Police Scotland, all of our the vast majority of our services are delivered locally by local personnel operating from local community fire stations, and they pretty much involve what you would typically expect from the Fire and Rescue Service, which is an emergency response. And we've got robust arrangements across Scotland for an emergency response to incidents, but also our frontline staff have a key prevention role to play as well. And we've been extremely successful through our staff in reducing the number of accidental dwelling fires across Scotland through preventative work. And we would much rather prevent emergencies from happening in the first place than respond to them. And if I can give some sort of an illustration in terms of the magnitude of the numbers we might be speaking about and the impacts that that might have. If we take our, and similarly to Police Scotland, we've done some financial modelling based on a flat cash budget going forward, and we've looked at kind of lower, middle and upper scenarios for both inflation and potential pay awards for staff going forward. And a conservative estimate of what we might have to save next year is £14 million next year alone. That would equate to 339 whole-time or full-time firefighters, and that would equate, those firefighters would equate to 18 appliances that we would not have the ability to be able to crew because of a reduced firefighter number of 339. So, and again, to put it in its context, we've got 116 appliances, full-time appliances across Scotland. So quite a significant number of our, proportion of our appliances we would no longer be able to crew, which would ultimately, and while we would always model that and not crew those appliances based on those appliances being removed that would have a minimum risk to community safety, changes of that magnitude, we would not be able to meet our current response times and things like that, which would mean that we would not be able to keep communities as safe as they currently are because of the magnitude of the changes that we would need to make.
So is it a question of response times? I mean, would there be a danger of not being able to attend at all?
We always attend every emergency at the moment. Now, clearly, the less appliances that we've got, we would still send the same weight of response to an incident, but that could be travelling further from further afield to get to an incident. So there are occasions where we need to stack calls on a risk-assessed basis, particularly if we've got spate flooding conditions, bonfire night and things like that. But generally, we don't have an issue with responding to every emergency call with a response immediately, but our response times would undoubtedly, on average across the piece, increase if we had less resources to be able to deploy with.
Thank you very much. Can I turn to a similar operational matter, this time for the police, and that's the issue of body-worn video, which I think Mr. Page touched on, Deputy Chief Officer Page touched on. And I think you said you're trying to protect delivery. Can you guarantee that body-worn video will be rolled out from next year in Scotland?
No, I can't guarantee that. Our budget is predicated on an assumption of a volume of policing. If any particular event happened that took an awful lot of policing resource, that would put huge pressure on the budget, and we'd have to find the money from that from other sources. So that would be... I couldn't guarantee it. What I can say is we're doing our utmost to protect the rollout of all of the, not only the National Body Worn Video project itself, but there's a number of underlying projects which you need to be in place. The desk project for the storage and the transmission of the data, infrastructure projects in police stations. Obviously, you've got to store the body worn video cameras themselves and the rest of it. So we are looking very closely at protecting all of the projects which you need to have in place to enable it to roll out. So at the moment, it's protected, but I couldn't guarantee it.
Okay, so the First Minister said in the chamber of this Parliament last week that government will start to introduce that technology next year. Do you, from your answer just now, does that mean that although the technology might, the background technology might be there, actual videos, you can't guarantee that police in Scotland, uniquely in the UK, won't be aware?
We're not in a position to guarantee it, but our current plans are that we will do that. But given that I can't predict what's going to happen in the next 5 months in terms of policing pressure, if there was a major emergency that took huge amounts of overtime, then we'd have to find the money for that. But our current plans are that we would continue to roll out national body worn video as outlined in our previous plans.
Okay. This is a particularly pertinent issue in the Highlands and Islands, which is the region I represent, which I think has the highest number of attacks per officer. Sure you know that, but to bear that in mind. My final question is around the projected brown numbers, police numbers. And I think you estimate that by 2028, police numbers will come down by over 2,000, I think it's in your submission. That assumes a 2% pay deal, is that correct? If the pay deal goes above 2%, is there a risk that more than 2,000 officers will be lost in the window 2024 to 2028?
Yes. If our budget settlements are provided in line with the resource spending review, flat cash, flat capital profiles over the next 5 years, we would then have to make a decision about whether to give any pay rise or not to give a pay rise. I mean, we don't run straight to workforce reduction as the only lever. We are looking to continue to look for efficiencies and effectiveness. We're running programmes internally. But as we've already said, 85% of the workforce, we've taken out £200 million. We took 1,600 staff, civilian staff, out of policing at the start of Police Scotland's journey. The resource spending review asked public sector bodies, quite rightly, to push ahead with public sector reform, to push ahead with collaboration, to reduce their workforces and to pay for their own settlements. We've strived to do that, but with 200 million already delivered, with 1,600 staff already delivered, with a non-pay budget of only 200 million facing the inflationary pressures we've got, we don't have that many places left to go. So, again, we discuss with the board, and these are finance discussions which we have at the force executive level because they're decisions for the chief constable, in discussion with the SBA board. The question this year was, do we give a pay rise or do we have a pay freeze? And the feeling was, and the Scottish Police Federation, the trade unions have been made very clear of the very challenging circumstances in which police operate. So the decision was to give a pay rise, and we've just gone through that process. We put 2% in the budget. We would hope to be able to fund a 2%, at least a 2%. And for our modelling purposes, that's where we are at the moment. I don't think there's much more we can do in efficiency. We will push very hard for efficiency, but it won't be enough to deliver the sums of money you need to give a reasonable pay rise, which is fair and affordable, to our workforce. It's a large workforce.
I don't know if any other of the police witnesses want to add to that. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to bring in Rona Mackay and then I'll bring in Katie Clark.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. If I could come to James Gray first. James, in your opening statement, you acknowledged that you received £80 million extra in your budget. You said half of that was spent on pay rises. Can you, sorry if this is a bit simplistic, but can you say how the other £40 million was absorbed?
Yeah, thank you. So, yeah, as you say, the first £40 million was went to settle the 22-23 pay award because it ended up being higher than we budgeted for. With the remaining amount, when we were building the budget, obviously we had significant non-pay pressures coming through. I think Mr. Thompson referenced some of the contract inflation for things like building repairs. We had something similar where, you know, inflation of 8-9% was applied to a very large contract. So we were able to allocate an element of the £40 million towards a pay award, but it was somewhere in the region of 2%, because the other part of the new funding that we received this year had to go to manage non-pay pressures. obviously 2% was never going to be enough to get to a reasonable position on the pay award, and that's why we built in additional savings into our budget in order to put an allocation aside that would be adequate. So it was just because this particular year with inflationary pressures, that in normal circumstances, to be given £40 million, that would have been, you know, a fantastic settlement in a 2% inflationary environment, but with inflation being so high. And understandably, you know, we're not sitting here being critical in any way at all. You know, we recognise that the kind of, you know, public finance environment, the wider, you know, economic circumstances are incredibly challenging. The money helped us, and as we've said, you know, it was better than we thought it might be, and it certainly helped us, and we're in a better position than we would have been had we not received it. But just given the level of pressure, given where we are on pay awards this year, as you'll know, with, you know, police officers at kind of 7%, you know, kind of extraordinary times, and that's just as a consequence of that has put a huge amount of pressure on the budget. Whereas, in, as I say, in any normal time, it, you know, that would have meant potentially that there would have been opportunities to invest into new areas, but that's just where we are, find ourselves this year.
Thank you. Thanks. Mr. Page, if I could ask you, could you maybe just briefly outline, you talk about your reform budget, what is that exactly, what does that mean?
So for since 2013 onwards, the Scottish Government had provided a £25 million reform budget, it was called a reform budget, to assist with the creation of Police Scotland, the reform of the 8 legacy forces into a single Police Scotland force. So that £25 million, which we'd received every year, had been allocated to Police Scotland but held by Scottish Government, and we effectively made bids to Scottish Government to draw down on that £25 million to make the reforms that we needed to make. That's been absolutely critical to Police Scotland to allow us to make some inroads into the digital data ICT transformation and address many of the other things you need to do when you bring 8 legacy forces together. For this current financial year, Scottish Government baselined the reform budget into our core budget, but with a caveat, quite rightly, that it be used for transformation purposes, which I think is really essential. The difference was this year that it was £20 million that was baselined into Police Scotland's budget, not 25. £5 million was held back by the justice portfolio for wider justice sector transformation, which we will benefit from in due course. So it's the £20 million worth of baselined reform funding in our core budget, which is the money that we use for transformation. So all the projects that we talk about, National Body Worn Video, COS, DESC, all of those things is funded from those projects. This year, we sought permission from the SBA to allocate £5 million of our core revenue budget to prop up the reform budget so it got back to £25 million. Because obviously we'd made assumptions about £25 million being the money available. We have a lot of projects that are multi-year projects. When the budget was cut to 20, it left a gap, so we redirected £5 million of our core revenue budget into the reform budget to carry on with those projects. Unfortunately, because where we are now with the budget pressures, we've already reallocated £3 million back into the core budget, and we're just about to look at reallocating more of both the £2 million that's remaining from revenue to go back into the core budget, and I'm looking at the £20 million that we've not spent already, and I've asked for work or by the change programme to see which projects can we pause or stop with the least impact on our policing capabilities to save money to redirect that into meeting the budgetary challenges that we have at the moment.
Okay. Just on the body-worn cameras, in the last term of Parliament, I was in the police subcommittee and we were talking about that then. That's 7 years ago. I'm just wondering why it's not been a priority for you, and whose decision is that? Is that operational or is that yourself? I mean, you couldn't give a guarantee that it would happen. So I'm just wondering who actually decides that.
It's always been a priority for us. We've had is that there's an awful lot of infrastructure you need to have underneath the body-worn video that people wear. There's no point in just buying cameras for people and giving them them, because effectively they can't score the data, we can't use it in a way that would be appropriate for evidence purposes and things like that. So We've had hundreds and hundreds of legacy IT systems. The digital data and ICT programme that we put forward in 2017 needed about, I think it was about £350 million worth of infrastructure investment. This was to address really fundamental gaps in our technology capability, which, for example, a Strathclyde officer, somebody based in Strathclyde coming across the Lothians, couldn't arrest someone because of they couldn't actually use their ID codes on our systems. Our systems were so disparate that we didn't act like a national force. So one of the programs you have to put in place before you get body-worn video working is the program that allows any police officer in Scotland deployed anywhere to be able to plug into their systems, and we capture it on a central database, and then we can use it for evidence purposes across Scotland. So it's always been a thing that we wanted to do because we were way behind the curve against England and Wales, but you've got to bring eight police forces together and create national infrastructure before you can plug a camera into it. And we're still some way away from that, because even if we deliver national body-worn video in line with the plan, the pilot won't start until July next year. But we've got the desk pilot, we've got the COS pilots and some infrastructure, because obviously we've got quite a large estate. There's an awful lot we've got to do to ensure that we can, the officers who use the cameras can download them. So the Wi-Fi infrastructure in the police station's got to be strong enough that we can download to the cloud and store the stuff safely.
So, sorry to interrupt, where are we with that then? Because 10 years does seem like a long time.
Well, where we are with it is we've got the full business case is going to the board in January 24. The pilot starts in July 24. The phase one rollout, currently planned, is August 24 to June 25, and we're looking to roll out 10,500. Mm-hmm. body-worn video cameras to the front line, and then we'll go on to phase two thereafter. But obviously there's quite a big timeline. It's a very major project. Mm-hmm. And there's a number of other technology projects that sit underneath that which we do need in place before we can launch body-worn video. Mm-hmm. So we are trying, as I've already said, to protect that to the best of our ability, but the budget pressures are stripping away the money from other projects other than the ones we're trying to protect. In terms of the decision-making, the decision-making goes straight into the force executive, and all decisions about operational priority for change delivery are led by our operational policing colleagues. Anything that we do in terms of estate, fleet, procurement, finance, the way we manage the money, we effectively produce the options and then present them into the force executive, which is the chief constable, the deputy chief constables, and the assistant chief constable supported by directors, to allow them to make a decision based on threat, harm and risk and what the operational priorities are.
Okay, thank you. I know I'm running out of time. Just very briefly, go back to James. You mentioned about the closure of maybe 30 police stations. Would that money go back into the capital budget as the fire service are doing?
That would be our intention. The money would go back into the capital budget for reinvestment, and the savings that were made on the maintenance and so on of those police stations would be able to be reinvested, hopefully some of that back into the retained estate so that we get it up to a better standard.
Thank you. And then again, just briefly for DCC Connors, you talked about the Thrive assessment and that it would be up to the individual officer to do that. Can I just ask you about training for that, how that's going? And also about, you'll know that we did quite a large inquiry about the mental health and well-being of police officers. How's that progressing?
So the Thrive assessments that sits mainly in our contact command and control centres, that training has been rolling out and continues to roll out. So it is something that's embedded. It's something that's part and parcel of that. And in terms of, we then have trauma-informed and other mechanisms that all officers and staff across the organisation have the ability to look and assess and work with each individual person. In terms of officers and wellbeing, it is really important that we understand the pressures that are coming down on all of our staff, and not just the officers, but the police staff in particular as well. And that programme led by Katie Miller is ongoing with lots of different work streams, and the ability, the openness culture that encourages people to actually come forwards when they're feeling that pressures are coming onto them. So it's not just about putting the systems in place, it's about creating the culture that we say, please do be open and come and talk to us. And as I've said, the difficulties for officers and staff in Police Scotland is wanting to deliver that service for the communities of Scotland and trying to do everything. And that's the bit that we need to manage so that we're able to do things well, deliver for the communities of Scotland, but look after the wellbeing of our officers and staff.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. indeed. So I'll now bring in Katie Clark, followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, and I'd like to ask Ross Haggart some questions. The backdrop, of course, is a decade of cuts to the fire service in Scotland, and Audit Scotland report that the Scottish Fire Service has insurmountable capital backlog, and information provided by the service to my office suggests that 45% of the entire estate is assessed as being in either poor or bad condition. In your reply to Polly McNeill, you indicated that only 5 fire stations could be prioritised. The FBU Decon campaign has highlighted the risk of contaminations to the health of firefighters, and some of that risk relates to the condition of the estate, for example, the availability of showering. So what consideration has been given to the legal duty of care that the service is legally obliged to provide to its workforce, and the risks of litigation and legal responsibilities of the service?
Thanks very much, Ms Clark. And as I've previously stated, mm-hmm. this is a real priority for us as a service. And I know that there's been 2 debates within Parliament on the subject. And as I've already said, the safety of our firefighters is of paramount importance to us as an organisation. As I mentioned to Ms McNeill earlier in my response, the estate is part of the solution. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, we need to have an ability to be able to invest more within our estates to bring it up to a suitable standard for a 21st century fire and rescue service. Notwithstanding that, there are other matters that we are progressing through our contaminants group in mm-hmm. terms of policies, procedures, operational practices, so that we can mitigate to an extent some of the issues that we've got with our current estate. But ultimately, a full solution will require policies, procedures, protocols, appropriate training for our firefighters to safeguard themselves from contaminants, but also the ability to go back to a fire station and have a proper, dirty, clean areas, be able to shower within 4 hours of being exposed and things like that. So all of these things need to come together, both the practical elements and also the estates element, but we take our responsibilities in this regard, as well as everything else related to firefighter safety, extremely seriously.
And have you had any advice about your legal liabilities, and is that something you could share with the committee, perhaps in writing? And also, could you inform the committee, perhaps in writing, of the work that you are able to do, some of the mitigation work that you've referred to? If you could keep the committee advised on that, that would be extremely helpful.
We'd be really keen to keep the committee cited on the work that we're doing in this regard. More than happy to do that, Ms Clark.
And in terms of the legal liabilities, is that something that you'd be willing to share with the committee? Because at the end of the day, it's all of us that will have to pay the price if the Fire Service doesn't meet its obligations.
There's always a challenge when it comes to legal advice and things like that, but wherever possible, we will seek to be as open as we possibly can with any information that we've got in that regard.
Thank you very much. And as you know, we had a huge fire in the Highlands in June, and 2 firefighters were injured. But across Europe, over the summer, we've seen wildfires and extreme flooding. And indeed, it's not just Europe, it's across the world. So the climate challenge must be at the forefront of your mind in terms of the implications on the fire service and the increasing demands there's going to be on the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. So what work is being done to look at what those increased demands are likely to be, and how we're going to have to respond to that?
Yeah, I'll probably bring in Stuart for some of the detail on that, if I may, because Stuart leads on all things service delivery. But just from a strategic perspective, we are acutely aware of the impacts of climate change. I spoke earlier in my opening remarks regarding what we are trying to do to mitigate our impacts upon the environment, mm-hmm. but quite clearly we've got a key response role mm-hmm. to play, particularly from a flooding and a wildfire perspective. We've got that as real priorities in order to ensure that we have got our firefighters appropriately equipped and trained to deal with those types of incidents, that there's a much greater risk of occurring, not just in terms of numbers, but in terms of the scale mm-hmm, as well.
Exactly.
And perhaps Stuart can provide a bit more detail around about the work mm-hmm. that we're doing in that regard.
Thank you.
Yeah, good morning, committee. In terms of the risk modelling element of it, we absolutely model through the natural environment as part of our Community Risk Index modelling programme, the impact of wildfire and significant flooding events. And clearly, we then build strategies to respond to those. As an example, we've upgraded all our water rescue teams over the last year, all 20 of them, with new equipment to be able to respond to significant flooding events. Alongside that, as the Chief says, we have our wildfire strategy, which is currently being implemented, and that will see significant investment made in remote rural parts of Scotland in order to mitigate the challenges of wildfire. But as you rightly say, there's various examples from around the world, and the challenge and the risk is very real. We are alive to that. We are not immune in Scotland from significant wildfires, as we've seen up north. It was fortunate that they've not at this stage impinged on significant densely populated areas, but that's not to diminish the impact they've had on the natural environment and rural communities. So we need to make sure that we are prepared to respond to that. And whilst we've invested in wildfire resources and capability, it really gives us a foundation to build upon. But as the Chief has already highlighted, we have significant challenges with our capital budget that we need. So significant more investment would be required in order for us to continue to meet that demand.
So this obviously is a budget scrutiny process. So what do you think the budget implications are of these challenges? Is that something that you've looked at?
The capital budget is clearly, we do a 3-year capital budget, and as part of that, we factor in the risks of the organisation and prioritise where the capital spend should be. But with competing priorities around the rack panel roofing, dignified facilities, mm-hmm. decon, wildfire, we have to factor in and prioritise all those with a very okay. minimal capital
Understand.
Budget.
And as you know, 10 appliances and additional height appliances were withdrawn across Scotland last week. Close to 1,100 uniformed firefighters' jobs have already been lost. And Ross Haggart, you've indicated a potential further 780 full-time firefighter jobs could be lost in the next 4 years. You've also indicated in your evidence today that firefighters may not be available for appliances that you do have, and that they won't be able to be staffed. But we know that we're already having concerns raised with us about the lack of availability of appliances and indeed increased response times. I know there's been reference to modelling already this morning, but what work are you doing in terms of what the implications of the lack of availability of appliances are going to have on the public and on response times? And what information are you able to share in terms of what's happened since the 10 appliances were withdrawn?
Yeah, so thanks for that. The 10 appliances that we have withdrawn as of last Monday mm-hmm. was done very much on a risk-assessed basis, and those were the 10 appliances that we identified would have the least impact upon community safety across Scotland. As I mentioned earlier, if we were to have to make budgetary reductions of the lower end of our predictions of £14 million next year, that would equate to an additional 18 appliances that we would not be able to crew across Scotland. Mm-hmm. And that's against a backdrop of 116 appliances that we've got, whole-time appliances, which is temporarily at the moment reduced to 106. So a significant proportion of mm-hmm. our whole-time operational appliances we would not be able to crew with a reduced number of firefighters based on the budgetary pressures. That will have a significant impact upon the organisation and the services that we are able to deliver to communities. As I mentioned earlier, we would always seek to minimise the impact mm-hmm. of that upon community safety, but we would not be able to remove resources of that magnitude without there being an impact upon response times and ultimately upon safety and risk within communities. We're doing a detailed piece of work just now. Stuart spoke earlier about our Community Risk Index model. That's one of the tools that we've used to underpin all of the work we've done to date. So we are doing a piece of work at the moment to look at what would the outcome of that modelling be mm-hmm. should we have to remove another mm-hmm. 18 appliances from the front line. Mm-hmm. And again, I would emphasise that modelling's ongoing just now. We would always seek to minimise the impacts upon community safety as best as we could through those reductions, but ultimately reductions of that magnitude will impact upon our ability to respond to emergencies across Scotland.
So it's fair to say that response times are going to continue to go up?
Based on the assumption of us needing to make changes of that magnitude, then we would anticipate response times would go up as a result, on average, across Scotland.
I understand. Thank you.
OK. Thanks very much indeed. And finally, Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. Hopefully last, but not least, is the phrase. I've got a couple of questions for each convener, if that's all right. Firstly, probably to James Gray and David Page. Earlier on, James, you talked about the issue about overtime, and you were looking at that. Now, I'm probably not going to be popular here, and apologies to any friends in the police who are watching, but because I know that they obviously welcome overtime like they would just now. But I wonder how that could play out in terms of your budgets. It would seem to be more sensible to reduce overtime to keep numbers. Is that something that you're looking at? Can you expand on that a wee bit about what the impact of overtime is in terms of figures and how savings might be made there?
Yeah, I can start, and maybe DCC Connors might want to speak about the operational benefit of overtime. So our core overtime budget is around £1 million a month on average. There's parts of the year when it's higher, so it is profiled. What we have seen during the course of this year is that we've been spending somewhere in the region of £1.6 to £1.7 per month. So we've been overspending, and the forecast of that is that we would end up potentially somewhere about £6 or £7 million over budget. And as I say, we're trying to bring that back into line. But some of the areas, organisationally, it's very difficult to, in fact, you know, it's unavoidable in certain circumstances, such as if you've got a court citation, and depending on the time period of that, the only way to manage it is through overtime. And in particular, if you're, I suppose, I don't want to get into too much of the operational side of it, so I'd maybe hand over to DCC Connors on that. But we have obviously had discussion around the relative amount of overtime, because it is a more expensive resource than just using straight time and having potentially more police officers. But as you reduce your overall number of officers, then the feedback I've been getting is that people would almost rather have a little bit more overtime in order to have that kind of flexibility and resilience in order to do things in the context of having a smaller workforce overall. But maybe
so just before we come in there, what would your projections around the people, what would you hope to achieve in terms of saving from overtime
in this current year?
Yeah,
at the moment we're not looking to save anything. We're actually just looking to try and bring the overtime budget back into line. Okay. which if we did that for the remainder of this year, would bring us back in about £5 million, and that's a component of our overall savings plan of £19 million that we spoke about earlier on.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. So, yeah, just to pick up on some of those points, I think the key thing to say is policing is unpredictable. It's always going to be unpredictable. It's very difficult to project forwards anything in particular, which is why overtime comes in. Overtime can be really tiring. The pressure on officers and staff at the moment, when you're kept on, your shift patterns are changed. So whilst overtime may well bring money into the bank for people with the cost of living crisis, it comes at a cost as well in that sense. So, you know, there's many things that we're trying to do in terms of event management, for example, projecting forward when events and different large football games are coming in, so we can give people notice and reduce the overtime budgets around that. We do have to make some decisions around proactivity, operations that are going to be run, what's going to be the cost, what's the benefit, where's the threat and prioritisation process. So managing that whole overtime piece actually has quite a lot of complexity. But the main things I will say is, much as we can manage the overtime, that's what we're doing. But it is a very spontaneous role that we all do, so having to manage that as well. But it does come at an impact on officers and staff when we rely on overtime to backfill or be able to deliver what we need to, because we don't have the resources that we need in the various areas.
Thanks very much. And you must have read my mind in terms of my next question when you mentioned sporting events here, because I was actually at Hampden last night for the Scotland match, and I have to say that there was a significant increase in police numbers there from previous games that I've been at all the games recently, the 5-game package. And even my wee boy who I was with notes, he said, "Oh, Dad, there's loads of police tonight." They were great, I have to say. They were interacting well with the fans and the kids and everything. But can I ask a wee bit about how that how these things are thought out. There was, there did, I don't know the exact numbers, but there did seem to be a very much large police presence last night. You were seeing a police officer everywhere you turned, which I suppose is a good thing, but in terms of the budget, which is what we're here to talk about today, the scrutiny of that, how do you take that into account and prioritise that? And I know you can't predict things, you just said that, and possibly what I'm about to say here is to do with the fact there was a large police presence, I'm sure you would tell me that, but it actually seemed a fairly friendly atmosphere last night. I didn't personally notice any difficulties, but, you know, how do you take this into account?
So there's different ways of doing it. Most of the event management is based on intelligence, experience. What's it telling us about the particular crowds or the dynamics or the game, whether it's a friendly, whether it's a cup game. So all of that will factor into the intelligence in particular. You then have the kind of the deployment model. You can hold resources. So you might have exactly the same number of resources on the game, but they're held backwards, so you don't see them, or they're put forwards to engage with the crowds, talk to people. So actually, it comes also down to your deployment model and whether you put people forward so they're visible or whether you hold them back so that the crowds can manage themselves again. So, but it is based around, again, threat and harm, intelligence, professional experience, what's the profile of that particular event, but also what's the deployment model, what's the style and tone that's required for that particular event as well.
Thanks very much. And just to reiterate, the police officers that were interacting with us last night were absolutely brilliant. Just one further question in terms of the police convener, if that's all right. Wanted to go back, it's for yourself again, DCC Connors. It was in terms of Russell Finlay's question around about the pilot. So I've got a question about what you would ask for us, because I think what you've said about the pilot in terms of risk of harm, risk of vulnerability, I think that is sensible measures, particularly given the cost cuts that we're all facing just now across the UK as a whole. So what would you ask of politicians around that? Would you ask us to be responsible in terms of that pilot? Because when I first heard about it last week, it was certainly portrayed, let's just say, differently to what you've said today. What would your ask be of us as politicians across parties, as a committee, in terms of that pilot and how we relay that to the public?
So I think, as I say, in terms of the pilot, and one final stage in the pilot is it's the local teams that then look at those particular reports, and they will look at it through a context of local knowledge. What's the particular area? What are the different crime trends? So it has lots of different lenses that are looked through before a crime is then said, actually, we are able to close this. There is no more investigation. So for me, it's the ability to speak to local officers, speak to local divisions, speak to the police, so we can give a really articulate and accurate account of what we're trying to do, so the public get, not the truth, because that's not the thing, but an accurate representation of actually what we're trying to do. We're trying to make sure that we do service delivery and not create any risk to the public. And this is something that absolutely will do that. Many people just want to report crime. We will be able to deliver that service as well, but it has a number of checks and balances to make sure that absolutely nobody who needs to see police is not going to see us. We have the checks and balances, including that local element as well.
Yeah, thanks for that. And I think it is very important that we help you to reflect that accurately. A quick couple of questions for the fire service as well, and a bit, I will be quick, convener. The first one is on, probably for yourself, Ross Haggart, and it's on the appliances. I've done a bit of work locally with my local fire station, Coat Dyke Fire Station, not too long ago, but certainly pre-COVID, and before budgets were as they were just now. And there was some discussion about appliances there, and I think there was some thoughts that maybe appliances would be lost from there. And when I got involved and started speaking to senior officers about it, there was a lot of discussion that this was a model the fire service were looking to do anyway. They're looking to do new models. So what I want to know is, how much are the appliance cuts to do with budget pressures, or are they to do with the way that the fire service is moving anyway? And I suppose the reverse question of that would be is, if there was a magic wand and you had all the money you needed, would you be reinstating these appliances, or would you be moving forward in a different direction?
Yeah, thanks very much for the question, Mr McGregor. And in terms of the current service delivery model that we've got for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, the work that we had been doing to identify risk across Scotland using our Community Risk Index model predated the resource spending review. And what that model identified to us is that there is currently an imbalance of fire cover across Scotland, because largely the cover arrangements that we've got in place at the moment are based on legacy arrangements that we inherited from 8 different fire and rescue services that deployed resources as they thought appropriate at the time. So we had identified that there was an imbalance of fire provision across Scotland, both in terms of the duty patterns that are operated from stations and the locations of stations and areas that have got greater and lesser provisions across Scotland. So we had set out a piece of work to look to harmonise that and make that provision of service more equitable across Scotland, and it was all part of our imperative to modernise the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and there are key elements to that modernisation. Part of that is the role that firefighters play within communities, and we've done a lot of really good work with the Fire Brigade Union to look at what an expanded role, a developed role for firefighters could be across Scotland, so that we could do with some modest investment, we could do more for communities and more to enhance community safety, both in terms of a preventative and an emergency response perspective. And we would also look to, we were also looking to rebalance our resources across Scotland so that we had a more equitable balance of resources across Scotland. We fundamentally need to reform our on-call provision. On-call firefighters cover huge land masses of Scotland, play a huge role in terms of protecting their communities, a hugely valuable role that they play, but it's a system that we struggle to maintain on a whole UK basis because people are living and working in different ways. And we also need to improve training for firefighters and use much more innovation and technology. So we understand that we need to modernise as an organisation, and we believe by with some modest investment in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, we can modernise. However, the alternative to reducing budgets year on year is that we just ultimately need to take more resources out of the front line, which will ultimately impact upon community safety.
Thanks very much for that answer. And my final question is on an area we've been doing a bit of work on within the Parliament, and I have to say the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service do a fantastic job with us, and that's around water safety. Obviously, access to wild waters is becoming more and more popular, both as a result, I think, of the pandemic and climate change, so warmer weather. I'm just wondering how much thought and resource in terms of the budget has been put into to the work you do around that, because, as I say, it is very good, and I think it's welcomed by everybody who's in that field.
Yes, so again, and Stuart might want to come in with some more detail. We are really committed to the water safety agenda across Scotland. We play a key role within Water Safety Scotland. We've got an officer seconded to Water Safety Scotland to lead that work. Like all incidents, we would rather prevent accidents from happening in the first place. And a lot of the work that we do through Water Safety Scotland with RoSPA is round about preventative work, mitigating work within local communities, but also, as Stuart's mentioned earlier, we've also got 20 water rescue stations strategically located across Scotland, and we've recently upgraded the equipment that they've got to deploy with as well. So we're really committed to water safety, both from a preventative and an emergency response perspective. I don't know if there's...
Okay. Thank you, Camilla. Thank
you very much indeed. So that's just brought us to the end of our session. Can I thank all the witnesses for your attendance this morning? And we're very much hoping to have further engagement with the new Chief Constable in due course, certainly by the end of the year. So thank you again. We'll take a short suspension just to allow our changeover of witnesses and a brief comfort break. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much. So I'm now pleased to welcome to our second panel Stephen McGowan, Deputy Crown Agent with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, and Eric McQueen, Chief Executive of the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. So I'm just going to begin with the same opening question that I asked our panel earlier on. So during scrutiny last year, both organisations here today painted a concerning picture on the state of your budgets, although this was relieved in part by extra funding. So can I perhaps invite Crown Office and then Courts and Tribunal Service to just tell us briefly what your experience of the financial situation has been for 2023 to 24, and what, if any, concerns and commentary you have as we approach the 2024-25 settlement. So I'll bring you in first, Mr McGowan.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the opportunity to come here this morning. So after last year's session, there was additional funding provided to us, and we're grateful for that additional funding, which addressed some of our essential needs, including the COVID recovery costs and the justice system more widely, the investigation of COVID deaths and a pay parity challenge that we've had over a number of years with Scottish Government Maine. We're realistic about the pressures on the public sector funding generally and the need to deliver improved outcomes. And while that additional funding was very welcome, it didn't address all of the minimum essential funding that we needed for 23-24. And so there was a shortfall in a number of areas. Those were for funding two additional high courts to reduce the pandemic backlog, to establish an evidence by commissioner unit so that vulnerable witnesses could give their evidence in a way more suitable to their needs. The costs for implementing new legislation, costs in relation to pathology services, which created an additional pressure on the budget, and costs arising from the continuing high inflation, which added another pressure to the budget. So we currently have £9 million of pressure on the budget. Due to the nature of the services that we provide, which are statutory and legal obligations, that is a tricky situation for us to be in. We have little room for manoeuvre in our budget. 82% of it is staffing, and much of the rest of it is committed to things like pre-contracted spending on things like pathology, etc. But we're working with the government to make sure that we achieve a path to balance, and we balance that budget this year. But it's a challenging financial outlook, it's clear.
OK, thanks very much indeed. I'll just bring Eric McQueen straight in.
OK, thank you, Convener, and good morning, members. Probably a similar position to what Stephen's outlined for the Crown. I mean, quite clearly, we painted some quite dire consequences if we're going to end up in a flat cash situation, and thankfully that situation didn't fully materialise. So we did get increases in terms of our core budget, which largely covered the issues round about what we thought was going to be pay increases at the time, covering largely the inflation in a lot of the areas. And we also received significant in-year funding to make sure that the court recovery programme, which is obviously an essential part of our operations, was maintained in its full. And we also received additional capital funding to put towards some of our critical building maintenance type projects. So I say that put us in a relatively good position, but again left some shortfalls and pressures in our overall budget. We have been able to continually drive efficiencies. So we have been scrutinising all budget lines through our good work of our procurement team. We have realised about £2 million in terms of procurement savings that we've made over the course of the last year. Our whole approach in terms of digital strategy is to move away from externally provided services to bring those in-house, and we're now making that move, and we reckon that will reduce costs by about 25%. So again, these are just things we're doing, trying to drive the efficiencies out where we can try to focus on delivering core business. Similar to the Crown, about 75% of our budget is tied up in people and buildings. So our area for manoeuvrability is quite tight. On the buildings front, we've reduced our investment in terms of backlog maintenance. That's been a risk-based decision on the basis that we have substantially brought down our backlog maintenance over the last 4 or 5 years. So this year we're putting slightly less into backlog maintenance. While that's a low risk for this year, that's not a sustainable position going forward. So that's again, that will be an issue and a pressure that we'll push into next year. Our biggest remaining concern in trying to find a way to that sort of path to balance is primarily around about pay and the pay increases. So our budget was very, very much based on public sector pay policy, where we were anticipating a pay increase of around about 3.5%. Scottish Government have now settled a much higher level, so they've gone beyond what was originally the public sector pay policy, where effectively for the bulk of our staff, it would mean an increase of around about 7% this year and an increase for the bulk of the staff of about 5% next year. That's put a real in-year pressure of about £3.9 million this year, which we're currently discussing with Government in terms of how we can close that gap. And it will have a knock-on effect into next year of somewhere in the region of about £6.5 million. So we're doing our best to manage some of the pressures we have. Quite clearly within the overall court business, we are seeing a continuing increase in terms of the more serious cases coming through, and that is a big issue in terms of the recovery programme. And as people will be aware, there's the ongoing challenges we currently have with GeoAmey, where there's a quite significant impact again on the operation of the court. So there's a range of things now that are adding to pressures to help to make us try to work through, get to a path to balance by the end of the year.
OK, thanks very much indeed. So I'm just going to use the same format as we did in our last session, and I'm going to hand over to Russell Finlay, and then I'll bring in Katie Clark. Just to make members aware, I'm looking at around about 8 or so minutes each, and if we have time at the end, we'll bring in some supplementaries. So, Russell Finlay.
Great, thank you. I'll keep an eye on the clock and try and be quick. First question, I think, is to Mr McQueen. On a recent visit to Victim Support Scotland's offices in Glasgow, they were showing us this new facility whereby witnesses should be able to give evidence direct to court from the premises. So far, however, the only time this has actually been used was a case involving a Canadian court rather than a court in Scotland. Do you know if this, maybe it's not a delay, but do you know if the non-implementation so far has anything to do with budgets, or is it more impractical purposes?
No, it's not to do with budgets. At this stage, it's more just practical issues. So we are looking at the technology connections between the new Victims Support Scotland premises, which I must say are excellent. So we have been out there, we have visited and working very closely with them. So we can use their premises for TV links into courts. Where we're trying to get a technical solution is how we can bring people in virtually from that premise for evidence by commission. And that's where the bulk of the work has gone. But we think we're fairly close to get a solution on that and working closely with Victims Support Scotland to make that a reality, because clearly having witnesses given their evidence from that type of environment is something we all aspire to achieve.
Sure, thank you. Now, the Scottish Government is legislating for the creation of a new criminal court, sexual offences court. Have you undertaking any work in terms of evaluating how much this might cost in terms of, I mean, you're not physically building new courts. This will be essentially a rebranding exercise, or will there be any costs?
It's a bit more than that. I mean, quite clearly that will be coming back before the committee, and that will be part of the financial memorandum which has been submitted, and we're currently just submitting our views back in that. So yes, there will be cost to the court service, as there will be to every organisation. Perhaps the most significant area of cost will be in relation to evidence by commission, because obviously the presumption of that bill is that all complainers and witnesses in these cases will give their evidence by commission. So one of the things that we have been doing is modelling work, looking at the overall cost of that. We currently have 4 high-quality evidence by commission suites now in place. So we have one in Glasgow, one in Edinburgh, Inverness, and the one in Aberdeen is just getting commissioned as we speak. And we have funding from Scottish Government next year to build another specialist suite in Dundee, which will be a shared facility with Victim Support Scotland. So we'll have their staff present within that area as we do in Inverness. So we are trying to model where we are on overall capacity. At the moment, we're actually dealing with about 800 evidence by commission hearings a year. So that's a significant increase in where we've been on previous years. And that current capacity that we have would give us a theoretical limit of about 2,000 hearings per year if we were able to use it to its full capacity. But what we want to achieve is a fuller spread across all sheriffdoms to make it an easy access for people attending these hearings.
And this is maybe a slightly technical question, but evidence on commission happens already. That's remotely recorded or recorded
prior. It does, yes.
But what I'm talking about, I think, is more live evidence from elsewhere. That's the issue that's being worked on.
Well, there's two things there. I mean, first, so the evidence by commission is in place at the moment for children in the High Court. What the new bill will propose is that that's a presumption that everyone within the Specialist Court will give their evidence on evidence by commission. So the whole theory of evidence by commission is to avoid people having to give evidence by live link to participate in a trial and give their evidence at the very early stage, reducing the trauma on the individuals involved. So that's clearly the big step change that we would see in terms of what would come out of that bill. In terms of live links, we already have quite extensive capacity across the country to give live links either from court to court or from individual premises. So we've got about 20 vulnerable witness suites that are external to our court buildings where people can currently give their evidence by video link at the moment.
Yeah, okay, thank you. The next question is from Mr. McGowan. It's just something that's in the submission that caught my eye in respect of civil recovery on page 16 of the Crown submission. It says that since 2003, the civil recovery unit has recovered over £20 million in cash and assets from criminals. I don't know if that number's accurate. It just seemed quite low. Do you happen to know if that's...
There's a lot of care put into the submission, so yeah. I think it's accurate. We can double-check that.
Okay.
I think that's an accurate
20 figure. Years' worth of cash and assets from organised crime, it doesn't seem like very much at all, but, yep, that'd be helpful. Thank you. Now, one thing in the submission that was notable for its absence was any reference to the Rangers malicious prosecution scandal. Now, the most recent public figure for the cost of this to taxpayer is £57.4 million, with £5.7 of that being to legal fees. So I understand the compensation payments included an undertaking by the Crown to meet any future tax liabilities if they arose. It's just to check whether in the recent months whether there have been any tax liabilities that have been met by the Crown or the Scottish Government, and whether that number has risen since it was published, and looking forward to the imminent inquiry, what kind of cost implication that might have on the Crown's budget.
So the figure that you have, the £57.4 million, that figure is the up-to-date figure. There's been no change in that figure. As ever, I'm limited by what I can say because of the ongoing litigation, and there is still litigation ongoing. The inquiry, when it comes, will be something which we have to budget for. We've already dedicated some resource to it, but I wouldn't have thought that it will be a major line in the budget. The wider number of public inquiries that we have at the moment is something that is a pressure on us, but it's a pressure that we're absorbing and managing.
Yeah, OK, thank you. And if I've got time, just very quickly, in respect of fatal accident inquiries and the increasing numbers of them, I'm just trying to find the relevant page in the submission. It's page 15 also. It says that 39 hearings are scheduled. These are brand new ones for 2023.
Yes.
So how many more are there? Works in progress, if you like.
I don't have the precise figure of cases that we have live at the moment in progress. The ones where the hearing is scheduled are the ones where the court's been petitioned. There will be a small number, and I don't have that figure, where there's an instruction and we haven't yet petitioned the court. We have an internal guideline where we look to petition the court within 6 weeks of getting the instruction to do that. After discussion with the court, the increase, I think, in the number of these cases comes from two things. Firstly, there's been a significant increase in the number of discretionary fatal accident inquiries over the last couple of years. That in part is due to the complexity of the deaths that we're dealing with now. We have many more deaths which are real complex deaths where we have issues of medical negligence, mistreatment, etc. And those are issues that require ventilation before a court. But I think we had 10 of them in the last year that we've instructed, which was more than the year before. So significant increase.
Right. And I suppose there's an expectation, I suppose, from some families who would like to see fatal accident inquiries taking place, and the Crown have to consider those on a case-by-case basis?
Yes. We have to consider those on a case-by-case basis. There's some other work that we're doing in relation to that. So we've got the complexity of the general deaths casework anyway. We have a deaths improvement programme at the moment, and one aspect of that looks at the public confidence issue more generally, and looks at doing more work to publicise what we do in our routine deaths investigations, where lessons are learned and there is material that comes forward which will prevent other deaths from happening in future, and how we can best publicise that and get that out there, perhaps in a way that doesn't require a full fatal accident inquiry, but means that there is public confidence that those lessons have been more widely learned.
It's not an FAI or nothing, there's lots of work.
Absolutely, so there's a continuum of responses within there.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll bring in Katie Clark and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor. Katie.
Thank you very much. And of course, one of the major challenges that we still face is the backlogs in cases. I know there has been progress, but it's still a massive problem, and that's having a huge impact, obviously, on all the individuals involved. The Crown Office submission suggests that the level of resource funding that may be required is around £207 million in 2024-25 to take into account pay rises. So could you set out how that figure has been reached and the potential implications if aspects of that may change?
So the £207 million or £206.8 million that we've set out in the submission to the committee, it firstly comes from taking what we assess has been necessary for this year at £182 million. It then takes into account those aspects of the budget which I mentioned were pressures this year, the additional High Court, the evidence by the Commissioner, the new legislation, etc. But over the past few years, we've been on a journey on pay parity. Pay parity ensures that those working for Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service are paid a similar amount of money than those in Scottish Government main, whether that be lawyers, whether that be support staff, whether that be IT professionals, whatever they are. Historically, they have been paid less, and that was an issue for us and led to issues with retention in particular. So there's a figure for that. And then in applying the Scottish Government pay policy, we think that that will require an additional £10 million to fund that pay award to keep to pay parity, so that the good work that's been done and the support that we've had from Scottish Government recently in getting us to that level will be retained. Were that not done, and where we did, if we didn't have that, then we've given some examples within the paper of what that would mean, and it could mean the reduction in headcount by about 200 people, which would be equivalent to Dundee, Aberdeen, not having fiscal's office. Mm-hmm. That's not our serious proposal, obviously, but that's the equivalent. So that's a significant equivalent, and there's no doubt that if that happened, that would have an impact upon the service that we aspire to deliver to the public, and the service that the public could expect from us might be below that which they can reasonably expect. There would be hard choices would require to be made.
So, I mean, the pay parity issue is clearly very important, because there's some staff and some groups of staff that have very legitimate claims in terms of their treatment and issues around about comparative, you know, pay. But the backlog from a public policy point of view is a major problem, continues to be a major problem. There was additional COVID funds. I know that there's always an answer that it's not just one part, you need resources, more resources in all parts of the justice sector to address this. But on what basis are you making these projections in terms of what you expect to happen to backlogs? Because it's some of the individuals that come to us outline really completely unacceptable backlogs in cases being dealt with. So could you outline your approach?
There is specific funding to deal with the backlogs, which is there until 26-27, and that's built into the budget at the moment. The backlogs are generational. They are bigger than they've ever been. They amount to a huge challenge. Over time, those backlogs are coming down, so cases have been taken off the summary backlog. Cases will be taken off all of the backlogs as time progresses, and we are progressing towards that. It's undoubtedly the case, though, that there are people at the moment, victims who are waiting for their cases to come to court, or who have recently had their cases in court, that they will have been waiting a very, very long time, and that
I appreciate it's very difficult for them. But the additional funding that we've got across the justice system as a whole is something that will help us bring that down over time. So gradually, those stories that you'll be hearing from constituents and those experiences should begin to improve. But that is a multi-year journey that we're on to get to that point.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, we obviously are passing legislation in this place. We've just passed the Bail and Release Bill. We're discussing the witnesses, the Victims and Witnesses Bill. I mean, what implications do you think they are going to have in terms of this coming year on your budget?
On the budget, it's difficult to say in relation to the Victims and Witnesses Bill because that's just going through Parliament, and we're like Scottish Courts Service at the point where we're beginning to model what that will mean, and it's almost inevitable that if we increase evidence by commission, which is one of the proposals there, and we do more work to engage with victims, that will cost more money. So that modelling is ongoing at the moment, and we'll be in discussion with Scottish Government as the year goes on in relation to that, and no doubt that will come back before this committee.
So can I just interject in that? So does that mean that you're expecting cases to cost more if these legislative changes take place? I appreciate that's not going to be this coming year's budget, you're not expecting it to be a streamlined, cheaper process. You're expecting it to be a more resource-intensive process that will cost the public purse more.
That's my expectation, that it will be more resource-intensive. So there is more resource in the Commission than there would be if everyone came to the court and evidence was given live. That's more... the preparation for a commission hearing is the same as the preparation for a trial from the perspective of the prosecutor who's doing it. Even though there may only be one witness, you still have to have all of the evidential aspects of the case covered so that the appropriate questions can be asked. So that would undoubtedly be the case. And then in relation to the Sexual Offences Court, some of these cases at the moment will go through the Sheriff Court. It costs less for a case to go through the Sheriff Court at the moment. The standard of preparation of those cases will change, so that it's the same as the High Court, I would expect, and so that, again, an additional cost for preparation of those individual cases. So I would expect it will cost more, but we're still modelling the extent to which that might be the case.
I understand. I don't know, Convener, if I've got time for an additional question. I know we've got time pressure. If I could just ask one quick question of Mr McQueen. Again, in the submission that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service have made, it's suggesting an increase of £13.4 million would be needed. Could you just briefly outline how that's been calculated?
Yeah, I mean, the £13.4 million is partly in terms of the pay award. So we reckon that based on current projections, we need £6.5 million to put towards that pay award.
And what's your projection? What pay, you know, what percentage?
Yeah, so this is on a projection that we follow the line that Scottish Government may have taken this year, which is a broad 7% increase, which obviously would impact on the baseline for next year. And that for the majority of staff next year, because most of our staff are in the lower pay grades, it would be a pay increase of round about 5% for those staff and 2% on staff on higher salaries. Okay. So our projections in terms of overall impact for next year are something in the region of about £6.5 million. On top of that, there has been a recent increase in terms of pay increases to judges. Now, while we don't recruit or pay judges, we do pay part of their pension, and just in terms of the way it operates, and also we pay fee-paid judiciary. So again, the costs of both of those are going up, and we reckon that will be in the region of about £1.5 million. We have some extreme pressures in mental health tribunal at the moment because of the growing business that's now going through there. And we reckon that we will need something about £1.4 million in terms of additional members' hearings for the additional hearings that we need to hold in mental health tribunal next year. And the final part of that £13.4 million increases largely to do with inflation. So this is even based on a lower level inflation coming in next year. We still think that will have an overall impact of a budget of about £4 million. So that brings us broadly to the £13.4 million.
Thank you.
OK, thanks very much. So I'll bring in Fulton McGregor and then Donald Cameron.
Hey, thanks, Convener. My first question is one that I hope actually links this session and the previous one, because I think my colleague John Swinney, in his line of questioning on the last session, talked about that joint-up thinking within the justice sector. Now, this will be no surprise to you, and I think actually it's probably been raised with you before, maybe even by me at a previous session, I can't remember. But we often hear from the police about the amount of time
that is in resource that's taken up by officers having to attend at court. And we all know that, and we've heard it many times. We heard it again today in talking about that, even going into overtime budgets. Is there anything that the service is doing to try and limit that, but further work with the police to see exactly how that can be handled to try and reduce that, and then that would impact on the police budget, which we've just heard about, and presumably your budget to an extent as well?
Yeah, I mean, if I'll kick off first of all, I mean, there's a number of things that we have been doing and are doing in that area. So at the moment, all police witnesses can be on standby, so they don't actually have to come to the court building until a time they're due to call. So the whole idea was that police officers could continue working within in police buildings before they were actually required to give their evidence. That was a stopgap position that was put in quite a number of years ago. From January 2022, we've had the position where police officers and expert witnesses in the High Court can now give their evidence remotely from their place of work. And so far, about 700 police officers and expert witnesses have now gone down that route. We'll be doing an evaluation of that in October, and we would hope to shortly be able to roll that out during the course of next year across the Sheriff Courts. Again, I think quite a game changer for the police, because this essentially means that anyone that was required to give evidence would simply give evidence from their place of work or from a police station or from a hospital if they were an NHS or a consultant employee, again significantly reducing the time that they would have to make that contribution. So I think that will have a significant impact. The other area where I think we will start to see early benefits is the summary case management pilot. So this is a pilot that's currently taking place in three courts, Dundee, Hamilton and Paisley, with a real focus on trying to bring cases to conclusion at the earliest possible stage and trying to avoid setting down and citation of witnesses for unnecessary hearings. So the key part is about the automatic disclosure of evidence at the earliest stage before the case calls, to allow the proper consultation and negotiation to take place between Crown and Defence before pleas are then made. What we have started to see through the pilot is quite a significant impact in terms of witness citations. So in some areas, police witness citations have reduced by 50%. Broadly speaking, other witness citations have dropped by about 30%, and we are starting to see the figures changing in terms of the earlier settlement. The pilot's going through a full evaluation at the moment, so that's currently underway, and we expect that evaluation will be completed in October, with the full evaluation taking place next March. Now, what we anticipate, if the evaluation confirms the positive progress that's been made, then there is the possibility that that could be rolled out to other courts in the near future, pending the full evaluation taking place in March. So there's a stream of things that are in place at the moment where hopefully it will bring positive benefits, particularly to the police in terms of limiting mainly the number of police officers that actually have to give evidence in the first place, but then provide a different means when they do have to give evidence to the court.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. That does sound really positive, because I think this is a bit of an ongoing issue.
Absolutely.
Over a number of years in terms of police officers' time. But I was going to ask about the pilot that you're talking about there, in terms of how that can impact resources across the board. And that's really interesting to hear that's up to 50% decrease. How do you think that can really change the way we do things in courts, in terms of, are you going to be looking at, and a bit in terms of like the police pilot that they talked about, is it going to be in terms of like risk and vulnerability and the sort of standardness, if you like, for want of a better word, of the case, and where that can all be agreed early on and save that?
Yeah, I think I'm sure Stephen will want to say a bit more on this, but primarily this is about trying to take a very different approach. So the key thing about this particular pilot is judicially led. So this has been led by Sheriff Principal Anwar, who's now the Sheriff Principal in Glasgow and Strathkelvin. And the whole emphasis behind the project is about sheriffs taking a much more focused and a much more hands-on and proactive management of the cases. So this is about proper case management from the very start to the very end. Mm-hmm. And the key part of that is about this very early sharing of evidence. So making sure that key evidence is available before the case calls in court, before pleas are actually tendered. So that hopefully will reduce the number of cases that are set for trial and reduce the level of witnesses and citations we're currently seeing at the moment, and at the end of the day generate a much more effective and an efficient system. But Stephen, I don't know if you want you say more about the time perspective of your role in this is critical.
So the summary system is almost by design inefficient, because the way the legislation operates in practice until now has assumed that everything will go to trial. And we know that cases going to trial are actually the exception rather than the rule. Less than 10% of cases go to trial. So what we do is we cite witnesses for cases at trials that aren't going to happen, and we prepare for trials that aren't going to happen. And there's a huge amount of resource that goes into that. What the summary pilots are doing through judicial case management and early targeted disclosure is getting to the point where those cases which we know will resolve in a plea of guilty at some point down the line, resolve by a plea of guilty at an earlier stage before we've gone to the extent of citing all of those witnesses, of doing the preparation for the trials that won't happen. As Eric says, the results that we have at this early stage are really positive, and if we can reduce the number of citations to witnesses by about 50%, that's got a huge impact upon the public, it's got a huge impact upon the police. It also has a huge impact in terms of freeing capacity of prosecutors, for example, to do other parts of our work in the FAIs that we've discussed, and the serious crime that we've discussed, and the sexual offences, and not preparing for hearings where we know that there's not going to be a trial. It eliminates some of that churn, and it's a real positive aspect of our business. So we're really hopeful that we get the results that we're looking for there. And it's important to say that this has been done without a legislative change. This has been done within the parameters of the current legislation through good judicial case management, through initiatives that we've taken up. It's going so well at the moment that we've been able to put some additional factors in. So we have enhanced the pilots whereby if we have a domestic abuse trial, we are increasing and enhancing the amount of contact that we have with victims throughout that period. So they'll be contacted within 2 weeks by a prosecutor to discuss the case, to give them the reassurance that they need. And there will be a meeting with the prosecutor before the case, not just at the court, but in advance of the case. And we're also supported in the early disclosure by the DESC project, which has been mentioned this morning, which has been funded by government. And that allows us to do this early disclosure in a way that is really convenient and logical and easy for people to use. So some real significant benefits if we can get that. And they will save resource along the way, and they will also speed things up and give a service that's much better for victims and witnesses across the piece.
It does sound very positive overall, but you know, what sort of discussions are taking place with defence lawyers, who would be a key part of making that happen?
They're involved in these discussions at a local level in each of the pilot courts. They're involved. Their feedback is really important in this. We need a properly engaged defence to make this work, to be there, to have those discussions with the clients. We know that they have some of these discussions with the clients at a later stage. The way the system works doesn't encourage that to happen until trial. Mm-hmm. So they're a really key part in having these important discussions about what material has been disclosed at an early stage.
Can I bring in John Swinney just to ask a very quick supplementary?
This will use up my slot, convener, because it's in exactly the same territory. And I don't want in any way to give off any non-encouraging tones here, but I'm really interested in why this has not happened before. Because you know, in paragraph on page 19 of the submission, I really welcome what's going on here. Please don't take anything discouraging from me. But it says this has been achieved without any additional funding or the need for legislation. Mr. McQueen talked about, you know, we've now got proper case management in the pilot by sheriffs. And you know, when I think about all that the criminal justice system wrestles with, the backlogs, the frustration about witness citations, the time it takes for cases to handle, and it begs the question, why has this not been done before? Why is it And what else could it? What else could be going on?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a fair question. I think
because ultimately, well, sorry, I'll let you answer.
I think it's a question we could ask across a whole range of areas. The genesis of this actually came probably about 6 or 7 years ago. So there was a major review of evidence and procedure carried out by Lord Carloway at that particular time, and a report published, I think it was actually back in maybe 2016, in terms of the future way that we should think about taking evidence and the inefficiencies in the current system. So that report had a lot of wide-ranging implications. So it pushed a lot of what we're now seeing coming out of Lady Dorrien's review. It was the genesis for the Children's Bairns House, which the first one is now being launched in Scotland, and it was also the main emphasis for this pilot was now taken in. This pilot was actually put in place in 2019, and it was halted because of the pandemic. The pandemic gave the opportunity to bring in judicial weed through the shared principle, to refocus the programme, the actual approach that's been taken, to really think hard about what we want to get out of this in terms of what would that case management look like. And that pilot has now been put back in place. It did recommence in September last year, but because of the difficulties with legal aid and government at that particular time, it was difficult for the legal profession to fully engage in it. With that part resolved, that engagement started back in earnest in January time, and we're now seeing significant results. So, yes, we can always ask the questions, you know, why not before, why never? But this has had quite a long time in terms of its genesis to get to where we are now.
But you'll understand where I'm coming from here.
No, absolutely.
That, you know, we're sitting as a committee, and there'll be other committees in Parliament hearing all sorts of issues about financial pressures, and here you're giving us concrete evidence of areas where no more money is required, just that the system has undertaken improvements. And I'm pressing about, well, where else can that be done? Because when we will come to consider the Victims and Witnesses Bill, and you know, I suspect I will come at that from the perspective of saying, well, why does this need to need to cost more? Why does this need to involve more resources?
If you look at the range of things that we're trying to take forward, I think you can see that same approach coming through. So I think there's very much a recognition that I think one of the positive things coming out of the pandemic is that actually things can happen quickly and we can move quickly. So the remote jury centres were a real example of how we moved in a very short number of weeks, a very different type of operating model. So we are taking forward and pushing hard now the whole thing about the police witnesses. We are now looking very seriously about how we roll out virtual custodies on a national jurisdiction basis across the whole of Scotland. Again, part driven by the problems that we are now experiencing by GUME, but how do we drive this in a different direction? We are doing work in terms of domestic abuse in Grampian Islands and Islands, where we want to take the whole of domestic abuse and essentially move it into a virtual court world. So we want to move to a position where complainers and witnesses of domestic abuse never have to come into a court environment, where in a virtual world we can get greater consistency in terms of specialised sheriffs and specialised procurator fiscals, and that we can offer trial diets within somewhere between 4 to 6 weeks to prevent that disengagement that happens with witnesses over a period of time. So I think there is a real renewed energy and drive across all criminal justice organisations that actually maybe the things that we thought were very, very difficult in the past are where we absolutely need to focus now. And I think the programme of change and reform epitomises all of those things.
Okay. Thank you. Please.
Thank you very much. Okay.
I will do.
Like it was meant to. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll bring in Donald Cameron and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill. Donald.
Thank you. I was very struck by Mr. McGann's comment about the summary system and saying that I think you said it's by its very nature it's inefficient. I mean, if there's one part of the system that should be efficient, it strikes me it's the summary part. And you know, you gave your reasons, and I you know, find that very compelling. But I just wondered if you could expand a bit on those reasons, because it strikes me this is, you know, absolutely a part of the system that should be, you know, working like clockwork.
So if you look at the legislative provisions, they operate in the way that they did probably at the end of the 19th century, where they assume that the police will bring someone to the court immediately and there will be an immediate trial. And the summary system really takes its nature from that. As time has gone on, obviously things have become more complicated and more cases have got into the system. As Eric McQueen has alluded to, some of the genesis of the pilots came from Lord Carloway's work. Some of it also came from reflection, and certainly we did this reflection in Crown Office about what happened in the previous attempt to reform the summary system in about 2006-2007, when the Criminal Proceedings Reform Scotland Act was passed. And that took us to a place in Crown Office where we thought that in order to get proper judicial management, you need to give the judiciary better tools. And the tool that we thought that we could give them was a copy of the summary of evidence from the police report. And that then allows the sheriff to look at what the case is all about and to begin with a more informed view to start to identify what the issue is in the case. So what's likely to be in dispute? That allows you to cite less witnesses, it allows you to have less items at court as productions, it allows you to begin to get that to that point where we can do things. And so it begins to allow a greater focus on each case, and that for us, in addition to the journey that we've been on with Lord Carloway, there's a bit of trial and error in that, and we have had the opportunity to try those things out. We tried some of it out immediately before the pandemic. We reflected on that during the pandemic, and we're out the other side of that now with some really useful lessons and some good signs of progress. So these reflections, as time go on, it should be the quickest part of the system, but the volume of cases and the fact that everything gets set to trial means that too many cases call, too little happens in those cases because there hasn't been that focus that we're now beginning to see the ability to bring to bear.
Okay. Turning to the backlog, are you confident that we will ever reach pre-pandemic levels, both of you?
I think we've been quite clear that we see that as being unlikely. And we see that as being unlikely because of the continued increase that we are seeing in terms of serious cases coming through. Mm-hmm. So if we look at the level of indictments over the last 5 years, in both the Sheriff Court and the High Court, they've increased by approaching 38%. So any notion, I think, of returning to pre-pandemic levels, I think went quite some while back. Mm-hmm. So this has been a continued level of increase. So what we've tried to set out in our modelling report is what we see as being that revised baseline. So previously in the High Court, we would deal on an average year with somewhere around about 400 trials. We think realistically that in future will be closer to 600, 650, potentially slightly more. Within the sheriff and jury business, previously it was about 500 or 600 trials. Realistically, that's looking more like 1,500.
Right.
So I think it's now not just the fact that there's been a backlog, but actually we're dealing with a different level of cases that's coming through the system. I think summary business is the one area where I think we will return to pre-pandemic levels. That seems to be the closest area. But in terms of solemn business, there has been a continual increase in terms of the case types coming through, and that's a trend that looks like continuing for the future.
Do you agree with that from a prosecutorial perspective?
Yes. If you look at the longer-term trend in serious cases, it's up. So significant increases. If you look back 5-10 years in sexual offences, etc., there's no sign that that's going to go down. We see every year that it might be slightly up, it might be slightly down, but that longer-term trend is on the up. So the longer-term trend, I think, for the serious businesses that will be there. The system was beginning to creak a little bit before the pandemic. We were routinely extending time bars, so that pressure's there. That's one of the reasons why it's even more important that we sort the summary stuff out when we've got the opportunity to do so at the moment, because it is a capacity builder in the wider system. It will free up resources elsewhere to begin to tackle those more serious cases.
And lastly, Convener, on the issue of sexual offences, I was noticing that both the Lord Justice General, in his introduction to the corporate plan in April 2023, stated that he makes the point the number of indictments in sexual offences is rising. And I think the Crown Office submission to this committee mentions an appeal case, is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Where there is a potential to significantly increase. So in budgetary terms, are you able to say what the impact of that might be particularly,
So the appeal case, the Lord Advocate's reference number one of 2023, as you'll be aware, is awaiting the appeal court's decision. And it looks at some of the older cases there's been on that particular case called Smith against Lees, and to see whether that's correctly decided in terms of what evidence is required to bring a prosecution, and in particular round about issues of distress. it is no doubt that there would be an increase in the number of cases that we were able to bring. We haven't been able to do modelling which allows us to put a figure on that, but if that reference was successful and we await the decision of the court, then clearly there would be an increase in the amount of cases that we could bring, not only at the High Court level, but I think also at Sheriff and Jury and potentially also Summary, because it would have far-reaching consequences in sexual offences and also potentially offences such as domestic abuse.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Polly McNeill and then finally Rona McKay.
Thank you. Good morning. We won't be able to answer all the questions I have this morning, but can I just put a marker down? You're going awfully fast in this reform, and I would just plead to give us some time with the committee so we understand. I mean, like John Swinney, a lot of the reforms we would support because we need to end the churn. But I do have some concerns about some of the human rights issues attached to virtual ailments. My first question is I'm confused about this because you might have heard me talk about the shambles of the Glasgow Sheriff Court on virtual custodies. And that's the sheriff saying that, and I agreed. So I moved an amendment which the government accepted during COVID so that virtual custodies could not proceed and they should be. I don't understand why you press released. Can you explain that to me? How can you proceed against the legislation?
I'm not sure of the amendment that you've moved. So virtual custodies are in place and they're covered by the existing legislation that's in place. Actually, it's also in place so that it can be done on a national jurisdiction basis. So
Can we have a further exchange in this? Because I specifically moved an amendment during COVID against virtual custodies because it was I can assure you what I saw, it was a complete shambles. And that's my concern about the reform. Is there going to be some further discussion on this?
I think this is, I suppose, and back to Mr. Swinney's point about, you know, why aren't we doing things faster? You know, I mean, I think if we look 10 years down the line and we look back, I think we'll question why are we moving thousands of people in the back of white vans every day and driving them all around about Scotland? Mm-hmm. Why are we picking people up at prisons, at police custody units at 6 o'clock in the morning, sticking them in a white van, driving them to sheriff court, having them sit in a sheriff court, crowded cells for 6 or 7 hours for a court hearing that might last a couple of minutes? And then at the end of the day, putting them in another white van to drive them to a prison. I think we'll look back at and say that's madness.
I mean, you say put it like that, what's the point if the custody court then lasts twice as long as it used to last?
So what we're trying to put in place is a model that will allow that to be done much slicker and much more efficient. We put virtual custodies in place during COVID as an instant crisis management situation.
Okay.
Yep, there was no great thought. The technology was sprung up. Right. We had to put something in place. And predictably, it got us through, but it didn't work well. Okay. Now, we did deal with 20,000 cases by virtual links during custody. Yep, and not all of those 20,000 cases were the disasters that you might have seen on Glasgow on that particular day. So the vast majority of the virtual custodies that went through actually worked pretty well. Yep, it wasn't a slight. We wouldn't see that as being a model for the future.
Okay, but what you're saying is that there'll be investment and it'll be different.
So what we're now putting in place, and we've now got agreement from all the justice organisations, from the Law Society and from the Scottish Solicitors Association, is to put together now a judiciary-led group that's going to look at virtual custodies and make sure that the model, that the technology, the provisions we build are one that people can buy into and one that we can deliver in a reasonable course of time.
Thank you.
But I say, please don't link it back to the quick and dirty approach effectively during COVID.
That's helpful. So in answer to Donald Cameron, this has been a long-standing issue for me, on the delays in the High Court and the law on 140 days. So you've said that you don't see reaching the pre-pandemic levels. Is there a target as to what you're aiming at?
I think there's two things there. One, we don't actually see the level of cases dropping to the pre-pandemic level. But what we are anticipating is that with the recovery programme in place, then those timescales will start to reduce. So within the High Court, we have now increased the capacity by more than 40% pre-pandemic. So there's now 40% more High Court trials on a daily basis than there was in the pre-pandemic period. So what our expectation is through time, and we expect we'll get to that revised baseline in about 18 months' time, where, yes, we'll still be dealing with a higher level of cases, but we'll have started to reduce some of the timescales involved. So at the moment, a High Court case has taken 43 weeks. So, you know, with all of these things, you know, when we talk about extensive delays, there's really three main parts to it. So there is the part of the police in terms of the incident and investigation. There is the part of the Crown in terms of looking at the evidence, a decision to prosecute. And then there is the part when it comes into court. At the moment, on average, High Court trials are taking 43 weeks to have got to that evidence-led stage. We are currently fixing trials for the High Court in 8 months' time. So already some of those periods are starting to come down, and as the recovery programme now starts to bite with the new capacity that we put in place, then we expect to see the timescale starting to come down, but we do expect the actual case numbers to still be at quite a high level in 18 months' time.
Thank you. And just finally, Stephen, the figure that you, I think in answer to Katie Clark, the 200 people that you might lose in the service, so what's needed to prevent that from happening? Was there a figure that you mentioned?
Yes, the figure of 206, almost £207 million for next year is the figure that we're looking for to cover all of the things that we need to
prevent
to do
those losses.
And from the pay impact. So that's the figure that we're in discussion about.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, and I'll bring in Rona Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. I'm conscious of time, so I will be quick.
No, it's fine.
Yeah, thank you. I'm finding this a very encouraging session. Thanks for the efficiencies that you've made and the reorganisation. Eric, I just wanted to ask you. You talked at the start about pay increases being a bit higher than you thought, etc., etc. So I'm imagining that will be helping you with recruitment and retention.
Yeah,
is that the case?
I've got to say, the increase of the pay level above what was in the public sector pay pause is one we welcome. Mm. So the pressures on staff, the cost of living have been really tough over the course of the last year, 18 months. Mm-hmm. So I say I don't have any difficulty at all with that level that we're now trying to reach an agreement on. Mm-hmm. We just need to find a way of making it affordable and manageable, and that's a discussion that we're having with the government. Yeah. So Okay. Certainly making sure that our pay levels for our staff are comparable across government and the public sector are a key part of retention and a key part of just expressing the value that we have in our staff.
Great. And Stephen, that would be the same for you with trainees and...
It's addressing that comparability with Scottish Government main to make sure that that was giving us a recruitment and retention problem, but the comparability allows us to address that.
Good, thanks. Eric, capital funding predictions... Anything you can...
Yeah, capital funding is one that's always tough for us. I mean, our core baseline budget is £8 million, which is nowhere near what we require. Mm. In recent years, through in-year adjustments and fundings, we've pretty much been sitting around about the £17 million, which we think really is the minimal level we need to run good and safe operations. Mm-hmm. So our capital budget covers both predominantly our building side and digital. And both of those are expanding and under pressure. So on digital, it's absolutely clear we need to have the right underlying infrastructure in place, and that's been a lot of work we've done over the last 2 years. And that will be the platform that will support things in the future, like the virtual custodies that we've been talking about.
Yeah.
Cyber security is also an increase in risk. And again, it's a little bit like what I heard Police Scotland saying earlier. When they were talking about police body-worn cameras, it's not about putting more video links in and more video screens in. It's actually making sure that the underlying infrastructure is not just one that we put in place, but one that we maintain and one that we continue to develop. So our view is that a £17 million capital budget is really the bare minimum we need to make sure that we continue in that type of development.
Just incidentally, you mentioned virtual trials, so I'm really pleased about your plans for virtual domestic abuse trials. I think that's a huge
step
forward. Yep. Uh-huh. Great. Any problems with the rack thing in the buildings? You know, the reinforced concrete?
Yep. We carried out all the desktop surveys early on this year in line with the guidance. Mm. We are now carrying out detailed structural surveys.
across 10 of our buildings that we think there may be some potential. Mm-hmm. The first of those was completed last week and there was no trace of RAC. Mm-hmm. I heard last night that the second building that we have done has identified that there is RAC panels within the roof area. Mm-hmm. At the moment, the investigations have said that none of them are damaged. There's mm-hmm. no deflection in the panels. So we think it's a safe environment. Those structural mm-hmm. surveys carried on through last night, and I'll expect to get the further results of them this mm-hmm. afternoon. Okay. The other surveys we will have completed as we get into October.
Great, thank you. I have a few more questions, but I'll leave it there. Thanks. Yeah.
Time for one or two more.
Well, yep. Just to ask Stephen about the Crown Office submission talks about the appeal court considering the scope of law of evidence in sexual offence cases, etc. And you said that could significantly increase. Do you mean that's going to mean staff? Is that more staff needed for that? Or
it's difficult to say until we see what the appeal court say at the end of the day. The appeal court might say that there is no change in the law as we've understood it since the mid-1990s mm-hmm. continues to be the law. If the appeal court says that some of those cases were wrongly decided, mm-hmm. we would have to read that and see exactly what it means to mm-hmm. see what the impact would be. Mm-hmm. But there is no doubt if they say that case was wrongly decided that it might well be that there are a whole series of further cases that we now could bring mm-hmm. to court. And we would have to then scope and model what the impact would be.
We just need to wait to see.
So we need to wait for the appeal court to issue their ruling and do that work.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can just come back in and maybe ask yourself, Eric, you mentioned white vans earlier on. And I know that there's been a joint decision, albeit on a temporary basis, to set time limits to avoid late night sittings in custody courts. So obviously that's very welcome for, in particular, lawyers and court staff. But I just wondered if there's been any modelling done in and around the impact of that. So my immediate thought on that is that that's potentially just going to create a backlog of cases that aren't dealt with into the evening hours. So it was just to ask a wee bit about that.
We hope and anticipate that won't be the case. And just mm-hmm. to give you a little bit of background, I mean, obviously the GAA situation has been deteriorating quite significantly in recent months. We understand that their resource levels are now about 25% below where they would expect to be. And we are seeing the impact across all courts. So in the last 6 weeks, we've lost 48 trial days. Because they've not been able to bring custodies or prisoners to the court for that. We're seeing a significant number of courts now that are sitting quite well late into the evening. So 7, 8 o'clock at night is now becoming almost the norm for a lot of our courts, and 9, 10 o'clock at night is not unexpected. That, you're quite right, is putting a serious wellbeing issue for everyone that works within the court environment. It means that people are working 10 and 12-hour days and then expect to be back at their desk the next morning, and that applies as much as it does for lawyers and solicitors as it does for mass staff or for the judiciary. That's working on the goodwill of everyone that's involved, but it's actually not a long-term sustainable position that we can continually ask people to work in that way. So in discussion with the judiciary have now issued guidance as a first step, and it is only a first step of a way we can try to deal with this. So the important part of their guidance is that in terms of all business which is procedural, the aim is to no longer bring people from prison unless it's absolutely necessary. So it would only be if those individuals were unrepresented, or it would only be if those individuals were going to plead guilty. Equally, the same would apply to anyone that was in prison that was being cited as a witness to a trial. Again, they would be done by a virtual link. So we hope that what that will do is free up capacity within GOAME to focus on the areas where we've got big gaps at the moment. So by setting the time limits of 7 o'clock on a Monday and 6 o'clock on a Tuesday through to Friday, what we hope is that by being able to divert the resources, we can avoid that situation, because quite clearly, end up in a position with a whole number of people that then remanded for a further evening may just compound the problem. So this is about how resources can be managed across the system to try to mitigate the impact. It is not, by any stretch of imagination, a solution in the long term.
I've got serious concerns that if the resource levels are 25% down at the moment, where might they be in 4 months' time or 5 months' time? That's why we're very seriously and very quickly working with and collaboratively with the legal profession and justice organisations about actually how do we move to a position where we could very quickly move to virtual custodies.
Yeah, thanks. That's really a very helpful update. And just one final point that I was wanting to just pick up on was the process of information transfer from police to Crown Office. And so police reports, evidence, and so on. And forgive me if it maybe has been covered off in earlier responses, but obviously that's a welcome part of transformation and reform. So I'm just curious about what, if any, update there is on that work in the context of the potential sub-budget implications for Crown Office.
Is that on the DESC programme that we've been talking about, the digital evidence capability? So that's been piloted at the moment in Dundee, and it's really positive. What it begins to allow is become be a platform whereby we can share CCTV, video images, photographs with the defence at an early stage. It then begins to be the tool that we use in the pilots in order that we can get this early disclosure, early discussion with the defence, judicial case management. It has wider impacts as well. Previously, things like CCTV, mobile phone footage would all have to be burnt onto discs and pen drives. All of that infrastructure, all of that handing out of things can be stopped. Whenever you have a disc, you run the risk that it can be lost, and that leads to all sorts of data protection implications. It rules them out. So it's a really important technical innovation where, because digital images, videos are so much part of life now, we're finding a sensible way to introduce them into the criminal justice system without going back to burning discs and pen drives, which is digitally prehistoric.
And I take it in the context of budget, then, that that will continue. There's not a kind of...
There's separate funding streams from Scottish Government into organisations to do that. We have our own funding that we need to do to make sure our systems are compatible with it, but that's all built into the budget that we've set out in the submission.
Great. OK, thank you very much. OK, I think that brings us to the end of this session. Can I thank you both very much for your attendance, and we'll have a very short pause before we move on. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. So our last item of business in public today is to review a supplementary legislative consent memorandum on the UK Government's Northern Ireland Troubles Legacy and Reconciliation Bill. This LCM has been lodged because there have been a small number of relatively minor amendments that have been made to the bill since we last considered the issue of consent and these amendments' impact on devolved competences. As outlined in the LCM, the new amendments fall within the Scottish Parliament's legislative competence as they relate to the way in which the Independent Commission for Reconciliation and Information Recovery carries out its functions insofar as they relate to Scotland of criminal investigations and of the review and investigations of death or harmful conduct, and they therefore require the consent of the Scottish Parliament. Before we start, I want to point out to members that these new amendments do not affect the key parts of the bill we have already looked at, and the Scottish Government has not changed its view that the Scottish Parliament should not consent to the relevant parts in this bill for reasons we have already discussed and, after a vote, agreed with. I should also point out that because of the timetable in the UK Parliament and our recess, the bill passed into law last night. So, therefore, all we need to do today is to note this development. So, can I ask if anyone has anything else that they want to add, or are we agreed to note the supplementary LCM? Are we all agreed? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so that concludes our business today. Next week, we will be joined by Jill Imrie to review the work of the Response to Deaths in Prison Custody Group, and we will also consider our approach to the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So I now close this meeting. Thank you.